lower court ruled against him in 2013.
I'm a scientist, and I have done more than 225 presentations on World Trade Center 7 and the Twin Towers, nothing beyond that. I have never pointed my fingers at anyone. I have presented scientific evidence, including the nanothermite paper, for that the official narrative of 9/11 is false, is wrong. That's all I've been doing.
Herit, a professor of chemistry for 40 years at the University of Copenhagen, said he plans to present evidence to the High Court that disproves the crackpot claim, including video of World Trade Center 7's destruction, dust samples, and testimony from two expert witnesses. Russian police claim to have found two men responsible for the recent murder of activist and Kremlin critic Boris Nemtsov. Reuters reports that five men were marched into a courtroom by mass security officers. One of the men is a former police officer from Chechnya, who apparently confessed to the crime. Nemtsov was shot and killed on February 27th near the Kremlin administration. The Liberty Beat is brought to you by Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. This is the Liberty Beat for Monday, March 9th, 2015. I'm Brian Hagan, reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
As Sao Paulo struggled to dig out after last week's devastating earthquake.
I'm just praying and helping.
One group was left with no one to care for them.
There is nowhere for these homeless dogs to go. There is no food to give them. There is no clean water. These dogs are going to starve to death.
I have to do the humane thing. I have to put these dogs down.
O'Brady Shaw is the only journalist compassionate enough to do what has to be done.
Put down 50 or 60 dogs today? I didn't want to.
Let me help you!
But their fate would have been much worse if I hadn't done it.
It's better this way.
O'Brady Shaw goes where other reporters won't and does the jobs other reporters can't.
I'm so sorry.
Gut Check with O'Brady Shaw, live from Sao Paulo, tomorrow night, only on the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live, and you, of course, can dial in toll-free here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Joining you in studio tonight, you've got me, Ian.
And me, Mark.
And you can join us online over at freetalklive.com, where you can enjoy the features we give away free, which includes pretty much the entire website. So drop on by, freetalklive.com. Let's jump right into your calls. Then coming up, the Bank of Canada is angry. I don't know if you've seen the headlines about people altering the face of their bills, the $5 bill there, to look like Spock, look like Leonard Nimoy. And apparently the bank doesn't like that very much. We'll give you that story here in a moment, plus many others if we get to them. But your calls come first. Let's go to Michael in Ithaca, New York. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Michael.
Hey there. Hey. I just had a quick question.
Yes, sir.
Yesterday you said that there was a marijuana reform bill that got into the Senate, but they didn't pass it.
So what you're talking about is in New Hampshire?
Yes.
So last year in previous years, there have been multiple bills, decriminalization and legalization, that have passed the New Hampshire State House. So they have passed the legislature, the state reps, to be specific, but the Senate had not passed those yet. So, yes, that's where it currently stands. There is a bill that will be voted on by the State House this week by the representatives. Then that will go to the Senate, and this will be a decriminalization bill. So we will see what will happen there.
But you said the last bills, they didn't pass through because they thought they'd be vetoed out?
That's the rumor. I don't know how true it is.
I was just wondering why they would not pass it on to get it vetoed and why they just let it sit.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense to me either, Michael. I can't explain that to you. If that's what happened, it doesn't make any sense.
All right, well, then I just had one other quick unrelated question.
Okay, sure.
I just wanted to know if in a ideal world, if dead people have rights to their property.
If dead people have rights to property?
Yeah, it's an interesting question, isn't it? How could they, right?
like if you were to bury someone and they were to go grave robbing and they take rings or jewelry or whatever, or if you just walked in a house and found them dead.
Well, I would say that the dead person isn't the victim there. That would be, basically a burglary. So, if you have a valuable figurine sitting on your dresser that you like to look at, I know my grandmother did, basically it's just there. You know, she knows it's there. She gets to look at it. If you put something valuable in a coffin, then you want it to be there, right? So that would be sort of violating the rules of the graveyard and sort of breaking and entering into somebody who's still alive's coffin, right? Like that coffin still belongs to somebody who's alive in some way.
Private property violation. But, okay, so what if you come across somebody who's dead in the streets of a heart attack or something like that and the person snatches their wallet? Would that
clearly
be a
that
violation?
Belongs to the heirs, though, right? I mean, like, that's pretty obvious that money belongs to heirs.
What if there were no heirs? What if it's just some unknown person?
Well, I can tell you archaeologists do this crap constantly. That's what their job is, right? Paleontologists going around robbing the people from the ages.
I think in some places the line you can draw is pretty clear. Like with the grave thing, okay, that's likely someone's private property. You're violating their private property rights. That's a pretty clear line to draw. But if somebody's just, lying dead somewhere and someone decides to snatch a necklace off of their neck, they don't necessarily know if that person has any heirs or not. And certainly the person who has died is not going to be able to call it into question.
Well, I would say that likely a person without heirs there's not going to be much of a kerfuffle about. First off, it's unlikely that they're going to have much to give away. But instead, there's not going to be much kerfuffle about something being stolen from them, because who's to raise the alarm? I suppose you could see the person doing it, and then you're just talking about basically a distasteful act, and there's no shortage of society punishing people for distasteful acts.
Michael, good question. Thanks for the call tonight. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. I think we might have talked about grave robbing in the past, but that's definitely a topic that doesn't come up very often. I mean, there's some things that will come up again and again on Free Talk Live, and that's one of them that has not come up very often. Cannibalism in that one.
Yeah, how can you have property rights if you're dead? And it's an interesting question.
Yeah, in order to have property rights, you have to be able to claim it, right? You have to be able to say, that's mine.
And also,
and I can prove it.
Yeah, I mean, the idea of somebody not having heirs, you don't really know that, right? They could have left, even if they don't have any relatives, could have left all their money to the Art League of New York or something.
What about taking the entire body? Like if, somebody dies on side of the road or whatever, and some weird necro comes by and just snatches the entire corpse.
God, this is bizarre. I don't care to talk about it. Thanks.
The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Of course, you can also join us on Skype. That Skype username is lrn.fm. Canadians are paying a strange sort of tribute to the late Leonard Nimoy. They're drawing his most famous character, Spock, from Star Trek, over a 19th century politician on their banknotes. The story from businessinsider.com. Nimoy died on Friday, and he got a variety of tributes. That's Friday of last week. The week prior to that. Anyway, he got a variety of tributes, not the least from Barack Obama, but few are weirder than the drawings of Spock on Canadian banknotes. It has become known as Spocking. It looks as if the fad goes back further. Apparently, Canadians have been turning Sir Wilfrid Laurier, the country's first French-speaking prime minister, into a Vulcan for years. But the Bank of Canada is unimpressed. According to the BBC, Canada's central bank, which is responsible for the notes, confirmed that the practice was not illegal, but said people should not be doing it anyway. Here's their official statement, quote, "The Bank of Canada feels that writing and markings on banknotes are inappropriate, as they are a symbol of our country and a source of national pride."
And the rocket's red glare. It was ridiculous. So they print some paper up and you shouldn't draw on it. You're a bad Canadian if you don't draw on it.
You don't love your country enough.
It's ridiculous.
The spokeswoman also said disfigured bills may not circulate for as long and risk being rejected by retailers.
Well, probably the electronic retailers, like the little machines that spit out sodas and stuff like that. Like, if you're trying to, the only thing you've got is a $5 bill, and you're trying to get some soda out of some machine, and somebody's drawn Spock on your bill, that would probably be frustrating.
Yeah, that's a good point. I don't know what it is that those bill readers look for. There are certain, you know, indicators that they are scanning for. So whether or not a Spock drawing would throw off a bill reader,
it certainly could, though.
It's uncertain. It could. It certainly could. More from the story here. The spokeswoman also said disfigured bills may not circulate. Oh, I already said that. Some other countries have been trying to get in on the act, but Laurier makes a much better Spock than most banknote heads. And so they show a few of the other.
He does make
notes.
A fine Spock, I've got to say.
So I think that, you know, I'm a fan of writing on money. I do stamp. I actually stamp every dollar that comes through my hands with a freetalklive.com stamp.
Most dollars.
No, almost every one. I mean, if I don't get a chance to get to it, then that's one thing. But generally, the only way I won't stamp a bill is if I receive the bill and have to spend it before I can get to my stamp.
Yep.
Which is fairly
unlikely. Pretty dedicated.
And, you know, it's actually, you know, one of the first things I was wondering when I started doing that was, well, is this illegal? Because you've probably heard that defacing or mutilating U.S. government currency is considered a federal crime. And turns out the people over at wheresgeorge.com have done the research. They've, you know, hired the attorneys to check this out. And they've actually got a part of their frequently asked questions on their website that kind of explains how the rules work there. For those that don't know, wheresgeorge.com is known for stamping bills and with like their website. And then what you do is you go to wheresgeorge.com, you type in the serial number of the bill, and it'll show you every other time someone else has typed in that bill's serial number. And usually it's quite a few. You know, it shows you how far the bill goes, how it travels and what period of time and where it ends up and what sort of transactions it was involved in. It's a cool thing. So they've been stamping bills for, I don't know, more than a decade at this point. And they basically said that as long as you don't obscure the serial number of the bill, then it's fine. So you don't really have much to worry about. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We'll come back with more. Plus, one U.S. senator says he's never sent an email. It's 2015. He's never sent an email.
He's not gonna.
Coming up here. It's Free Talk Live.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
It takes a lot of courage to face your own death, but I'm glad I finally did. See, I was putting off getting life insurance to protect my family, even though I knew it was important. Then my neighbor's husband died. I watched her struggle emotionally and financially. It really made me face reality. If my husband died, how would I pay the mortgage, the car payments, or keep up the life the kids and I had? I realized I needed to get us life insurance right away. So I called AIG Direct. In less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing my family has protection.
Call AIG Direct right now for a free, no-obligation quote. The call takes less than 5 minutes, and you can save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-463-9184. That's 1-800-463-9184. 1-800-463-9184.
Gold, it's like nothing else on Earth. From the Romans through the Renaissance, from the Industrial Age to the Space Age, gold has weathered the test of time. For 6,000 years, gold has remained the ultimate store of wealth. According to the World Gold Council and the U.S. Mint, demand is at an all-time high. The stage is being set for the reemergence of gold as the common-sense alternative to a fiat paper currency that gets weaker every day. Midas Resources is proud to offer the hard-hitting report that arms you with the truth you need to protect you and your family from the Fed's plans for your hard-earned money. Don't gamble with your future. Call Midas Resources today and ask for your free copy of As Good as Gold. Call 1-800-686-2233. For the report the Fed hopes you'll never see. As Good as Gold can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. If you have ever thought about owning gold, you must read this report. Call Midas today at 800-686-2237.
Hi, I'm Derek J. To me, an activist's calling is to actively work to advance a cause. The cause for which I work is personal freedom. I believe my life is best when I engage in voluntary interactions and self-government. I reject the idea that anyone else has a higher claim to my life or my body than I do. I see people who call themselves the government as a threat to my personal freedom. I realize you may feel differently, but my relationship with the people who call themselves the government is completely involuntary. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com. That's victimlesscrimespree.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You may take control of the airwaves toll-free. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. With you tonight, Ian here.
And Mark.
Join us online, freetalklive.com. All the features are free on the site. Once again, that's freetalklive.com. FortGalt.com is where you can go to learn about a new movement of people who are getting some very affordable accommodations, who are looking to establish a little home base in the country of Chile. It's a fascinating project, and it's not a sprawling valley of vast estates or anything like that. It looks more like a condo building at a ski resort and has some pretty cool common amenities like a makerspace full of tools, a restaurant, and a bunch of places to relax and socialize. Look, the way America's been going lately, it's hard not to think about getting out of here from time to time. So go to FortGalt.com. There's only room for about 100 people, so don't wait until it's too late and the place is full. Check it out for yourself at FortGalt.com. So, it wasn't too long ago, probably, I don't know, half a decade or so, when on this program we talked about how the FBI still hadn't figured out email yet. Well, it turns out there's still some people in the government who haven't gotten with the times. Now, remember, email is an ancient technology by technological standards. I don't know when it came out, but it's been around since before the internet. It was back in the day... When I used to be on what was called the bulletin board systems, this is before the internet, you would call up these old computer systems with your dial-up modem. You remember the...
You have mail.
Dial-up modems, yeah. So, now this was before you have mail. That was yes. AOL. That was a centralized system. AOL was a centralized system that had nodes all over the United States with local phone numbers that you could call in and dial at this large system. BBSs were on much smaller scale. BBSs would have maybe a few hundred users, and they would serve service local areas. If you wanted to call a BBS outside of your local area, you had to pay long-distance fees. So you were paying per minute if you wanted to call any BBS that was outside of the local calling area.
If you had a few emails over there, how long would it take to download those?
Oh, not long. I mean, emails are small. They're still just text, and that doesn't take a whole lot to send that out.
I wouldn't think it would be.
But the way it used to work back then was they had services like FidoNet, where, and I'm sure I'm not exactly describing it correctly, but essentially you would, okay, so I would call my BBS in my local area in Sarasota, mm-hmm. and there was a bunch, there was dozens of them in Sarasota. So call a BBS that has FidoNet. And then I could send an email to you. Let's say, Mark, you were living somewhere else. You and I happen to grow up in the same area, but let's say you were living in Michigan.
Okay.
And you called your local BBS, and they also had a FidoNet. Well, at nighttime, the service, the FidoNet service, would run, and it would call out, it would kind of like use a phone tree to call other BBSs and deliver the email to those BBSs and collect whatever email was sent from those BBSs. Are you following me so far?
Yeah, sure.
So that's how it would work. The BBSs
took a little while for delivery, though.
Yeah, would call one of them. I mean, it could take a day or so to actually retrieve the messages that are there for you. But it still worked, and you could still send messages over long distances for essentially zero cost, the cost of calling the BBS. So email's been around for a long time. We're talking at least 25 years, and it probably was around in the 1980s. I just wasn't there to really understand it at that time because I was born in 1980, and so therefore, you know, I was 10 or 13, you know, 10, 12, 13 kind of range when I started getting onto these BBSs. Anyway, Senator Lindsey Graham from South Carolina says he's never sent an email, according to Fox News.
Before we go on and talk about you know, how far behind the times Lindsey Graham is, consider that email really, even though it's an old technology compared to the internet, it didn't really get kicked off until the internet. The vast majority of us didn't get our email addresses.
So then it's 20 years old.
Something like that.
Yeah. Because the internet started to kind of hit in the mid-1990s, but it was around in the earlier 1990s. And in some, you know, some would point out in its earliest forms, it was around in the 1980s. But as far as the popularization of the internet, yeah, mid-90s. So that's still 20 years. And how anybody can have gotten to the year 2015 and not have sent an email is pretty shocking.
It's
especially in a position like a governmental position like this.
I think you should just stick with it at that point. If you have managed to make it until 2015 without sending an email, stick with it. Just say, I'm never doing it.
Graham, a Republican, acknowledged Sunday he has never sent an email either on his congressional or a private account. Quote, I don't email, Graham said on NBC's Meet the Press. Quote, you can have every email I have ever sent. I've never sent one. Graham has for months publicly considered seeking the Republican presidential nomination. And they go on to blather about his presidential bid. Graham's lack of email use in a world both inside and outside of the Beltway that essentially relies more each day on social media could pose a challenge for him if he becomes a presidential candidate.
If, yeah. So would this preclude a candidate for you if they hadn't sent an email? So, like, let's say, okay, we're going to have to move to an alternate universe here for you. Let's say you voted for Ron Paul, is that right?
In the primary, in the Democratic primary, yes.
At some point, you have voted for Ron Paul?
Yes.
So if Ron Paul came out in 2015, looking at a 2016 bid or whatever it is, and said, I've never sent an email, and I likely never will because I'm old, would that preclude you from voting for him?
Well, because Ron Paul's so principled, no.
Right.
It would not.
Okay. So I've got to say that I think that this is sort of a fluff nothing story because it wouldn't preclude me either if a person fit my preferences. Now, I will say that Lindsey Graham is a bland nothing candidate who is likely to end up on the trash heap of history as far as he's better off not running for president because it will make him not look as bad. This is a failure waiting to happen, not a victory in the making. And so
it's going to be hard for anyone to get any traction, I think, in the presidential election if they aren't at least somewhat with it, with the times, so to speak. I mean, this would be a huge step backward if you think about it. Even something you can credit the Obama administration with, and there's not much I would credit them with that's positive, but something you can credit them with is at the very least they used social media and they seem to understand that. They, you know, his advisors or his administrators, they've used this and they continue to use it. When he got elected the first time, I think, they went online and they did that thing where ask Obama a question and people could submit the questions they wanted. And the most popular questions or the most popular question would be asked. And actually, the most popular question was a question about marijuana prohibition. And he did not answer in a very satisfactory manner. But nonetheless, the theory was there that, you know, they were paying attention to the internet, even though they didn't really care about what the question was.
Yeah, Obama's much more an e-candidate than Lindsey Graham is. Yeah. And Lindsey Graham's not that old of a man, comparatively. He's younger than Ron Paul,
okay.
Looking here. But, I think that this is not a strike in his favor. But I don't think that it's that big of a deal because I don't feel like the people that were going to vote for him, that small percentage of people that really care whether Lindsey Graham becomes the next president of the United States, those people are swayed by this story. Nor do I think that the people who are, you know, looking at and chuckling at this were going to vote for Graham anyway.
You can share your thoughts here. Would it make a difference for you whether or not someone would has not ever sent an email? Presumably, he hasn't read them either. I mean, if you
somebody prints them up for him and puts them on his desk.
Maybe. Toll-free number, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Are you in Lindsey Graham's camp? Have you also never sent an email? Are you a Luddite? Tell us about yourself. It's Free Talk Live.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins. But did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
Who did you let down today? Your wife? Your kids? Well, how about yourself? Take a look in the mirror. If you're tired of your drug and alcohol problem, you need to fix the problem and right now, before you hurt or kill yourself, or worse yet, somebody else. Call the addiction specialist now at the Detox and Treatment Helpline, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. If you have private insurance, we specialize in finding you the right treatment. When you call right now, you'll speak to a recovering addict who understands what you're going through right now. Let us help you break your addiction to drug and alcohol before it's too late. This call is completely confidential and free. So if you have private insurance, take 5 minutes of your time. Call right now. I promise it'll change your life. 800-208-5187. 800-208-5187. 800-208-5187. Call right now. 800-208-5187.
Are you tired of your taxes funding endless occupations around the world? Antiwar.com is run by people who understand that wars abroad become wars at home, wars on our freedoms. Antiwar.com is dedicated to bringing you the latest in news, views, interviews, and reviews from the top movers and shakers in the anti-occupation movement. Antiwar.com has it all, from thorough foreign policy analysis to interviews with whistleblowers who used to run the military-industrial complex. Antiwar, pro-free market. That's Antiwar.com.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll-free to bring up what you want. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Joining you here tonight, it is Ian.
And Derek J.
And Mark.
A very sleepy Derek J.
Good morning, everyone.
So we'll continue here. We'll take your calls about whatever you want. For those of you just tuning in, it turns out there's this senator named Lindsey Graham who says he's never sent an email. Coming up, we'll talk about another raw milk situation, which we haven't discussed in quite a while. And Derek, you're pretty intimately familiar with some of these raw milk controversies where farmers are being threatened by government agents. Well, it's happening again, and Mark's got that story. But we'll continue here with your calls in a moment. I want to let you know about how to get some great coffee for free. Well, the cost of shipping, but the pound itself of BuzzBox coffee will not cost you anything. It's 100% organic, top 1% grade Arabica, and shade-grown coffee. It's delicious coffee. And when you go to coffee.freetalklive.com, you'll get on their auto-ship program, which means that you'll continue to receive BuzzBox coffee, the flavor of your choice, in the amount that you choose, and at the frequency you select. It's customizable. You go to coffee.freetalklive.com. And a portion of the profits from each pound will go to help people make better lives for themselves through microloans from Kiva.org. So, again, go to coffee.freetalklive.com. Get some great coffee. Mark, you drink this coffee every day.
I drank it this morning. I didn't drink it while we were at the Liberty Forum because I didn't bring it with me, and I didn't really have a way to brew it. And I got to say, the coffee, not so great there.
So let's continue here. Your calls and thoughts. Johnny B. in Missouri. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Johnny B.
Y'all doing today?
Welcome, sir. Go ahead with your thoughts.
Well, you was talking about stamping on the money and writing on the money. Struck a chord with me, my man. I used to sign like you every piece of currency that went through my hand.
You'd sign it?
Sign it. I'd write on it.
Okay.
Websites, direct links to articles, anything I could think of. And it actually started with Mind my crossover here, but it was the Republic Broadcasting Network.
Yeah.
With Michael Bednarik and John Stadtmiller.
Okay.
But it was interesting. I actually had some places refuse to take my money.
Just because how big was the writing on it?
About the first 3 months, it was the whole face.
Okay.
No, actually, the whole backside. I started out with the backside. And I ran out of room there, so I moved over to the face.
No.
And I had somebody point it out to me.
You're literally writing, let's just say you're writing like a paragraph's worth of writing on each side of the bill, like a lot of words?
Pretty much.
Wow. So how much of the actual bill was visible, like through the lettering, through the penmanship, if you will, the actual strokes of your pen? How, like 50%, 70% of the actual green and white coloring of the bill was visible?
Well, when I started out, I was using Sharpies.
Ooh, okay.
So there wasn't a whole lot.
Yeah, I would say that would be why, right? So if you're obscuring the bill to the point where you can't easily identify what it is, then that would I would also be concerned as a vendor, somebody who is trying to sell a product. I'd worry that, you know, the bank might not want this, and if I can't give it to the bank, then what the hell good is it?
Well, the ink of the bill would bleed through. It wasn't that I was obliterating the whole thing. All right.
Yeah.
The refusal, the vendors that refused to honor the currency were post office, county offices.
What were
no price vendors. Places where you would pass off these bills?
What was that again?
Where were the most successful places to pass off these bills? I would assume bars and such, like services, businesses, restaurants.
Outside of the federal offices and the state offices, everybody else didn't have a problem with it.
Yeah, so it's the people with the biggest biggest sticks in their butts that wouldn't take it.
It's interesting, Johnny B. Anything else you want to share tonight?
Well, yeah, man. Actually, I had it pointed out to me that there's actually a law about writing on the bill.
And what is that?
They informed me that it's that border around the face. That's what that is there for.
For writing
on? After about...
The border around the face, it's there for what exactly?
It's there to write information into.
Well, that doesn't make much sense. You're talking about that oval around the president?
No. No, the border around the edge of the bill.
Oh, around the bill.
Mm-hmm.
You can't really write much in there. That's fairly thin.
I don't know. Did they cite a law to you? Because
yeah, that sounds like BS.
Yeah, that just sounds like somebody yickety-yacking to me.
Look it up in the currency laws.
Well, did you look it up?
A little bit. No, actually, I didn't worry too much about it.
Then I'm not going to look it up if you haven't looked it up. Thanks, Johnny B.
Here was my defense.
Okay.
Here was my defense, guys. It wasn't U.S. currency. That's a foreign currency that the U.S. government forces us to use.
I think there's a pretty good argument that it's not U.S. currency because it doesn't belong to the United States government. It's printed by the Federal Reserve.
I think that's what
whether
he's
or not
saying.
It's foreign, I think is there's an argument, but
it's certainly private, right?
Yeah, it's private.
Thank you, Johnny B. Appreciate it. Toll-free number tonight is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. I started by writing on my bills, but it was just too time-consuming, so spent the $12 to buy a stamp, and I only stamp my bills once typically, unless something goes wrong with the stamp when I stamp the first time, then I'll stamp it the second time. But I don't want to obscure the entirety of the front of the bill. I want it to be more noticeable. I want the stamp to stand out as the only thing that's on that bill and catch someone's attention. So anyway, we're talking about stamping bills. You can share your thoughts with us here. Our toll-free number, 855-450-FREE, or people who don't use email, this Senator Lindsey Graham saying, quote, "I don't know what that makes me," he said on NBC about not using emails. Well, the word would be a Luddite, Senator
Codger.
Graham, somebody who's shockingly unable to email. When you become a state legislator in New Hampshire, they give you an email address. I don't know if they do that with the federal government.
Some aren't very good at using it, I can tell you that.
Yeah. I imagine that's the case.
They're significantly older than Mr. Graham is.
And I would presume there's no obligation to use it, that they don't have to check their state emails. But most of them that I've ever emailed have been responsive on it.
Well, he probably has staff who takes care of his email for him. Maybe he personally hasn't sent the email, but his assistants have.
And when he gets the emails printed up and set on his desk in the morning, that doesn't exactly count as not having used email either, right?
Let's go on here to your calls on Skype, where Dave is on the line in Montana. Hello, Dave.
Hey, yo, Free Talk Live. How you doing, man?
Hey, Dave, what's on your mind tonight?
Hey, the Canadian Treasury's freaking out because Canadians are turning the picture of the guy on their $5 bill into Spock.
Yeah, that's actually the story we opened up with tonight.
Yeah. I called about, I'm a Luddite or a email illiterate. Matter of fact,
I don't believe you. I mean, how can you be an email illiterate and be on Skype? That seems like it just doesn't
I never did it. I never did it. I sent two emails in my whole life, and one was to you guys to verify who I was when I first registered for the chat room.
Huh. So you don't have to get a verification email from Skype when you sign up with an account?
My son did that for me.
Okay.
And my son is my coach. Like, the only thing why I could do stuff on the internet is because I was taught that particular thing. Like, he taught me how to paste and copy and all of that.
Well, I mean, if you've been in a chat room, and you have, you've been in the Free Talk Live chat room, which is easily accessible at our webcam page, cam.freetalklive.com. If you've been in the chat room and you're on Skype, you do not qualify as a Luddite. I mean, a Luddite is someone who
But
is
I never
essentially
got an email. I never sent.
Well, that's okay.
I don't use it. And if
it's
I
not necessary
to
use email. There are young people these days who don't use email, I suspect. You know, they're only text messaging one another, for instance.
And I got something else to say.
All right, stand by. We'll bring you back for that. More with Dave here. Definitely not a Luddite, but maybe you are. Which would mean you probably can't call the show. 855-450-FREE, that's 855. And technically, you shouldn't be listening because you have to use technological means, even though radio is like 100 years old, to listen to the show. 855-450-FREE, you can share your thoughts here on Free Talk Live.
Hey, it's Mark of Free Talk Live, and I want to tell you about a new way to be prepared for emergencies. Not just big emergencies, but little ones too. It's a source of backup power, so small that I can put it in my pocket or the glove box of my car, but it's so powerful that it can actually jumpstart a bus if I need it to. Sounds crazy, but it's not. I'm talking about a breakthrough in portable power technology called the Pocket Power Plus. If you get stranded in an airport, in your car, or you just want to go off the grid for a while, the Pocket Power Plus becomes your own personal mini power plant. Run pretty much any kind of electronic device for hours, even days if you need to. The Pocket Power Plus can also deliver an enormous supply of on-demand power that can jumpstart almost any vehicle, even in the coldest winter days. Comes with free jumper cables and an accessory pack. Best part, my listeners can now get Pocket Power Plus for half price by going to PocketPowerPlus9.com. That's PocketPowerPlus9.com. Use coupon code FTL to save even more. Go to PocketPowerPlus9.com, PocketPowerPlus9.com, coupon code FTL.
If the IRS has garnished your paycheck or seized money from your bank account, you need to get professional tax help now. Fast action is required to put a halt to these aggressive IRS collection tactics. You can count on the knowledgeable team of tax professionals at Wall & Associates. With over 30 years of experience, Wall & Associates has settled the tax problems of thousands of taxpayers for a small fraction of what they owed. For a free face-to-face consultation, call 1-800-425-4610 to put a wall between you and the IRS. 1-800-425-4610 or look for us on the web at wallandassociates.net. We solve tax problems. If you hire Wall & Associates today, you'll never have to talk to the IRS again. To stop the levies and seizures today, take action now. Call Wall & Associates at 1-800-425-4610. Wall & Associates. 1-800-425-4610. Based on actual cases, results may vary. Not a solicitation for legal services.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on, joined the Free State Project and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com. Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938, 877-357-9938.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime, 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
This is Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll-free and bring up whatever you would like to discuss. 855-450-FREE. Comment on stuff we've already talked about or bring up something completely different at 855-450-FREE. $4.50 free.
You want some great deals on some high-end wine? How about wines that are about between $70 and $100 per bottle, between $12 and $20? Those are big savings, up to 70%. You can get it at chwine.com. We got the Cameron Hughes Wine Variety Pack here at the LRN Studios. And It was awesome. I mean, these wines were much better than what I'm used to drinking.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it.
So just go there and, you know, get some big savings. This is an offer that simply will not last. Go use coupon code FTL. You click on the microphone. It's on the go to chwine.com. Click on the microphone. It's in the upper left-hand corner. Enter in FTL and save big. Don't wait. You need to try this wine now. It's amazing, and this offer will not last. It's really awesome wine.
The offer is free shipping.
Right? Yeah, the free shipping that you get. I'm sorry, you use the coupon code FTL. You get the free shipping.
Because you normally get those awesome prices at chwine.com.
I was just thinking about the taste of the wine, and I guess I forgot about the deal that I'd worked out with Cameron.
You weren't
over the
drinking
phone.
Some before the show, right?
No. Okay. Well, not today. chwine.com, coupon code FTL.
All right, let's continue with Dave in Montana. He's back with us here via Skype. He called himself a Luddite. I say, no way. You know, you can't possibly be a Luddite, someone who essentially shuns technology from their life, and be on Skype with us and also have been in the chat room.
Well, I'm part Luddite because just my cassette deck just broke about 2 weeks ago.
Oh, no.
He's making a pretty good argument.
And I went to go buy a CD player, and I found out that CD players are obsolete, and now everything's MP3. And so I got a deal on the CD player, and I bought my first CD ever. Now I got 11 of them.
Oh boy, that's pretty cool,
and
man.
I'm getting all the old music. But
yeah, you should get the MP3s. That way you don't lose the music, but you could burn them.
Yeah, my son is gonna hit me up to the. To eat the MP3 things, because my CD player was one of the first CD players that got a little port for the MP3 little chip thing, you know,
the USB USB drive.
Yeah.
Well, those things are cool,
all that's
man.
Brand new to me. I mean, like I said, the guy that put in the stereo, he had to show me how to use the CD player.
Just because you're a little behind the times or behind the technological curve doesn't mean
you're a Luddite. I got 150 cassettes. I wasn't going to throw them away. They work perfectly fine.
Hey, what is your age?
58.
Okay. Yeah. Hey, good call, Dave. Thanks for making it tonight, dude. I appreciate it. You know, I don't think that makes him a Luddite, though. That just means, you know, if you're happy with the technology you have, then you don't feel the desire to upgrade it when something new comes about. And there's something to be said for skipping a generation. I mean, if he managed to be happy with those tapes that entire time, he didn't go through the process of what a lot of people do, which is, oh, now there's this new technology out. I've got to rebuy everything I had on this new technology.
Do you think that'll happen with MP3s? It kind of feels like we've reached the pinnacle. Right, like now that you own the music on MP3, that this is it. You don't have to replace the stuff you had on album with cassette. You don't have to replace the stuff you had on cassette with CD. You don't have to replace the stuff you had on CD with MP3. Like, this is it. Like, this is the way the music is going to be. Am I wrong?
Well, in MP3 format?
Right. So, well,
they'll have higher quality formats.
You'll still be able to play these things. They're not going to deteriorate.
Yeah.
And MP3s come in a variety of different qualities. How much higher quality do you need than a high-quality MP3?
Well, like, apparently it gets much better because Sony has come out with, like, new cards and new technology for, you know, a much bigger audio file.
Okay, so to answer your question before we go on, Mark, the best, from what I understand, the best quality is what's called FLAC, FLAC, which is essentially it's a compressed lossless audio format. Lossless meaning that normally when you compress audio, MP3 is compressed audio. Uh-huh. When you compress audio, you lose some sort of data. You lose some kind of audio resolution.
You just have to lose it.
The more that you compress it, the more of that resolution you lose. So an MP3 that is 32 kilobits per second is not going to sound as good as an MP3 that is 64 kilobits per second, and that is not going to sound as good as one that is 128. And so if you're listening to human voice between 32 and 64, you'll be able to notice the difference. So you can try it with our streams. You go to listen.freetalklive.com. We have a 16K, a 32K, and a 64K. You can hear that. If you tell me you can't hear the difference, okay, well, then you might need to get your hearing checked, because there's, to me at least, a significant difference between those three. And if you can't hear them between, if you can't hear the difference between 32 and 16, or excuse me, 32 and 64, then try 16 and 64, and you will hear the difference. I mean, 16 sounds like you're listening through a tin can, and you know, 64 sounds like full human voice quality. But there's also a, more of a difference when you when it comes to music, because the frequency range of what you're hearing is much wider, right? There's different instruments, and some of those instruments have very high-pitched sounds, and some have very low-pitched sounds. So human voice only exists between a certain range of frequency. I think it only goes up to around 7,000 kilohertz, if I'm – wait, 7,000 hertz, rather. I think that's where the human voice kind of tops off at. And then music, of course, can go all the way up to the full range of human hearing. So you want to have at least 128 kilobits a second on an MP3 to at least have a decent sounding musical track in stereo. But ultimately, you know, 320 is sort of the preferred for MP3. But FLAC, it manages to compress music files without losing any information, without losing any resolution. So I guess what's going to get better in the future is there will be better, more efficient versions of FLAC. There will be something that makes FLAC take less space, because right now FLAC files are larger than MP3 files. So that's really the only thing they can change. Music can't get much better, at least as far as I know. I'm certainly not an audio expert, but I do kind of work with audio for a living.
Yeah, and how much more compressed does audio really need to get once it's digitally stored? I think the major focus is on increasing the storage capacity.
The storage
capacity
gets larger. That's true. Yeah. There's probably not as much of as a demand for these increasing compression algorithms, at least for audio. Video, on the other hand, continues to get higher and higher resolution. So you've got 1080p, which used to be the kind of high-res standard. Now there's what's called 4K, which doubles or quadruples or something, 1080p. So television displays are now coming out that have this 4K resolution to them. It's hard to find videos that are 4K, but YouTube is now supporting 4K. So that's coming next. And so for video tech, you're going to continue to see that expand. And there's never, I mean, maybe there's going to be a topping out for video at some point as well, but we're certainly not there yet.
Hey, you used the word Luddite earlier, and I've heard it before, knew the meaning, but I decided to look it up anyway, and I found this. I thought it was interesting. So, of course, we've got the definition: a person opposed to increased industrialization or new technology.
Right. These were the Luddites. Then, they went around the factories back in the Industrial Revolution and broke things.
Well, that's what I was going to say next. I had no idea. They were English workers who destroyed machinery. That's pretty cool. Not well, that well, that's yeah, cool to
this was going on in the
machinery,
80s.
But I'm saying, like, that's a cool background to the word.
This was the thing going on in the 80s in the United States. This is like, the robots are going to take our jobs. And so, you know, to some extent, we had this sort of happen again.
Really?
And
did
the robots,
people break machines again?
I'm sure that there was some
this was in
around,
the early 1800s, it
well,
says. Yeah.
I mean, you can damn well better believe this is going to come around again, right? Because the robots
not.
Are coming. The robots
yeah, but
are
people
here.
Need to know how helpful these robots are. I mean, like, think about the checkout counters, the self-checkout robots, or...
Yeah, but people don't like... A lot of people don't like that stuff.
What about the robots that allow you to order your meal from a fast food restaurant without getting it screwed up a million times by some teenager? That would be great. I mean, these robots are really helpful.
Well, there's no doubt robots are coming, and I think they're a great idea, but there are going to be a lot of people who are threatened by them, who will, like in the past, like when mechanization and automation created destroyed some jobs but created others, the people whose jobs will be destroyed by these robots are going to be some of the ones who push back against them.
Wow.
And whether they're going to get violent, whether they're going to sabotage, destroy property, you know, how far they'll go remains to be seen. And then on top of that, you also have there's you know, probably the people who not only don't appreciate the robots from the fact that they're worried about their career, but also the people who are worried that the robots will take over, right? Because we've certainly had plenty of pop culture, whether it be the Terminator or whatever, where the plot line is robots destroy the Earth or take over the Matrix, for instance.
I want to see people, those people in particular, start fighting robots, maybe on a TV show or something. Yeah, there used to be like robot wars or battle bots.
They're bringing it back.
Yeah, but instead of
robots fighting each other. I think they
fighting
should upgrade
humans.
It, yeah, and have it be robots fighting and destroying machines, if they can.
I don't think that's going to like, humans are not going to be able to fight robots. You're talking about things that can make decisions very quickly. Yeah, you know, they're made of hard metal. Humans are made of squashy meat.
You're just not up for the challenge, Mark.
You're right about that.
Maybe they could make a squishy robot. 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. In fact, they probably will for sex purposes. It's Free Talk Live.
God.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
Shiny badges on your jacket. Shiny badges. Yeah!
This is Davi Barker from ShinyBadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at ShinyBadges.com, write WORMS in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, Mark, at freetalklive.com. The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, March 9th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.84 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,172 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $279. Antiwar.com reports a U.S. airstrike hit an oil refinery in northern Syria yesterday in territory held by the Islamic State, killing at least 30 people, including a number of civilian workers employed at the site. Rebel mouthpiece, the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, reported that some of the Islamic State militants were killed in the attack, but that the rest were refinery workers from the surrounding area. Territory of the Islamic State includes most of the oil-producing regions of Syria, and the U.S. regularly targets the oil infrastructure there, saying it will deny the Islamic State the funds they get from oil smuggling. That's likely true, but the attacks are also badly crippling the only meaningful civilian economic infrastructure in those areas, in essence attacking the civilian economy militarily in the hopes of doing some damage by proxy to the occupying force. Bitcoin Not Bombs is a launching pad for nonprofits and social entrepreneurs into the financial freedom of the Bitcoin economy. Bitcoin Not Bombs is fully committed to being the hub of the nonprofit sector of the Bitcoin economy, maximizing the potential cross-promotion of all our clients and commercial partners. To learn more, visit BitcoinNotBombs.com. UPI reports one of two Swiss pilots will attempt to lift off from Abu Dhabi Monday for the first solar-powered flight around the world. Pilots Bertrand Picard and André Borschberg will attempt to circle the globe in 12 long flights over 5 months. The solar plane, called the Solar Impulse 2, can only fit one pilot, but they will fly the trip's segments in shifts. The plane is thin, with a long wingspan at over 236 feet across, and the wings are covered with over 17,000 solar cells. The plane can fly at night because of its ability to store energy it collects during the day. The plane will touch down in the United States, India, Oman, Myanmar, China, and either Southern Europe or North Africa, depending on conditions. The pilots have been planning the trip for over a decade, and Sir Richard Branson of Virgin Group is supporting the project. Part of the goal of the project is to promote green energy and environmental awareness. For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. Reuters reports the Greek finance minister said in a newspaper interview on Sunday that Greece could call a referendum or have early elections should its Eurozone partners reject its debt and growth plans. The new Greek government, led by Alexis Tsipras, won an election in January, promising to renegotiate a bailout agreement with the International Monetary Fund and its European Union partners that requires strict budget discipline and sweeping economic reforms. The government reached a temporary deal with its lenders last month, and Athens has until the end of April to specify the reforms it will make in exchange for further aid. Eurozone finance ministers are meeting on Monday in Brussels to discuss a letter of pledged reforms by Athens last week. Should Brussels ultimately reject Greece's proposals, there could be problems. In a statement released later on Sunday, the Greek finance ministry said the finance minister was responding to a hypothetical question and that any referendum would obviously regard the content of reforms and fiscal policy and not whether to stay in the Eurozone. Most Greeks want the country to keep the euro, but two-thirds also continue to back the tough stance to renegotiate the bailout package. A referendum over a deal with lenders that keeps the country in the Eurozone but falls short of Tsipras's promises could give the government cover to accept a deal even though it was elected with a different mandate. But even floating the idea of a referendum is politically risky. With the Tsipras government's popularity above 40%, the finance minister said, people understand that the government is fighting the establishment that said it was saving Greece while it put everything on the backs of the poor. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
This is the Fact Zone. I'm Brooke Alvarez. Our top story tonight, Congress has passed a bill naming incomprehensible shouting the official language of the United States.
I'm sick and tired of listening to people who say that Americans should not know what to know, and that's not what it is, what the policy is. The red-blooded American is what we have in this day and age.
Under the new law, public school classes will only be taught in incomprehensible shouting, and government agencies will no longer offer translators to non-shouting speakers. In addition, a new test will be added to the naturalization process, whereby potential immigrants must prove they have a working knowledge of incomprehensible shouting before they're granted citizenship. The movement started in 2008 with a grassroots organization called Americans for Doing It Right, because we gotta now, because who else right? Come on!
This is the Onion News Network, a tomahawk of honesty in the skull of lies.
And this is Free Talk Live. You may bring up anything that you'd like. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Coming up, Derek J. is going to tell us about the so-called Internet Freedom Act. I have not heard about it until you just mentioned it, so I'll be learning quite a bit.
Yay!
Also, speaking of the Internet, Ross Ulbricht's attorneys have put in a motion to get a retrial. Now we'll see how that goes.
Cool.
Ross Ulbricht, of course, the man accused of running the infamous underground black market known as the Silk Road. We'll give you the latest on his case here in a little bit. Our toll-free number is 855-453. That's 855-450-3733. And Mark, you had wanted to tell us about a raw milk story, yet another saga of yet another farmer who is under fire from some government gang. Which state is this happening in? Which states?
I think this is out of Minnesota.
Now, this wasn't Minnesota.
Not Minnesota,
where,
again.
Yeah, wasn't that where you went to, Derek J?
No.
That,
No.
You went to Wisconsin.
I went to Wisconsin, Dairy State, to attend a trial of Vernon Hershberger, a raw milk farmer. But in Minnesota, before his trial, there was a man named Alvin Schlangen, who also won against the state for the crime of selling and distributing his own raw milk
to
private customers. He did win. Not on all counts. There were other things that he was convicted of, unfortunately.
Mm.
But I'm shocked that in Minnesota this could happen again after Alvin's case, because it sort of sent shockwaves throughout the whole country for other raw milk farmers and gave them sort of the go-ahead to keep selling their raw milk to their consumers.
So what's happening, Mark?
This is as early as March, as recent as March the 4th. So,
wow.
A fight is percolating. You got to have puns when you, have raw milk.
Does milk percolate?
No, but coffee does, and you put milk in it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's the best I can do. I mean, I'm not writing it.
All food articles and, like, prohibited stuffs articles have a lot of puns.
Yep. A fight is percolating in Cook County over the rights of farmers to sell products without interference from the government. The Duluth News Tribune reports that the Minnesota Department of Agriculture is asking a court to levy a $500 per day fine on farmer David Berglund. Now, the name Berglund sounds very familiar to me, but I just can't remember from where.
So, there's a guy named David Berglund who wrote a book called Libertarianism in One Lesson, I think.
I read that.
Yeah.
That might be it.
I don't know if it's the same David Berglund, though.
Well, there's also a David Berglund who received the U.S. Libertarian Party's nomination in 1984.
That's the guy who wrote the book.
Same guy, yeah.
But whether it's the same guy who's the farmer, I don't know.
Lakeview Natural Dairy Berglund's farm sells raw milk, and he's refusing to allow state inspectors onto his property.
Mm.
The case is drawing a growing measure of regional and national attention for its converging issues, including individual rights and organic farming. Berglund is not commenting to the media, but his attorney, Zanis Bayer, explained the fertile legal territory into which the case has tread. It's a fundamental right of us citizens to engage in a private transaction without having the nanny state peering over our shoulder, saying, "Thou shalt not do this," Bayer says. According to documents filed by Bayer with the court, the Berglund farm is more than 100 years old, having been started by Berglund's forebears who immigrated from Sweden. Located on Cook County Road 56 off the Gunflint Trail northeast of wherever it is. They sell, eggs, milk, cream, skim milk, butter, yogurt, beef, and eggs to customers who visit
all of the which, by the way, in the wrong circumstances, could make you sick. Right? Eat some rotten eggs, some curdled milk. You're gonna have a bad time with that, or whatever it is.
Yeah, you'll probably never eat a rotten egg, but you could say salmonella from it.
Yeah,
like a rotten egg really lets you know this is not the thing to be eaten.
Sure.
But I find it interesting they don't list chicken here. They sell eggs and they sell beef, but they don't sell chicken.
Hmm.
If there's a fight over farming and freedom, it probably involves milk. So the news of the Berglund's case is spreading quickly. Here from Nourishing Liberty, what the Berglunds are doing in providing food to their community is historically what built this country and continues to build communities. They are cultivating land for the purpose of feeding their neighbors. They are adding to the aesthetics of their region by keeping land in production. The Berglund family is lovingly growing community and nourishing bonds between community members. Now people who work for the MDA are assuming authority, deciding that they have the right to lord over this peaceful family and demand that the family conduct business in a new way that would quite literally put them out of business and steal a wonderful resource from the region.
Right. They've been doing this for, presumably the good part of that 100 years, likely selling products to their neighbors voluntarily on a consensual basis. And everything's been fine. But now these government bureaucrats want to bust their way in. They want to stick their nose in their business, poke around their house, poke around their farm and their whatever processing facilities that they have as though they own the place.
Listen to this. The fight comes down to this single sentence in the Minnesota Constitution. Any person may sell or peddle the products of the farm or garden occupied and cultivated by him without obtaining a license thereof.
Well, great. Let's start growing marijuana in, come on. I mean, obviously this stuff doesn't apply, right? I mean, they can just do whatever they want because marijuana has been prohibited for a long time in Minnesota. You can grow that in a garden.
Yep. Well, yes, you can, I suppose. This was added in 1906 before marijuana was illegalized.
Yeah.
And I couldn't tell you.
Well, it sounds like they just add an asterisk to that part of the Constitution and then say, except when the government doesn't want you to.
Well, in 2005, the Minnesota Supreme Court ruled that the amendment does not allow a farmer to sell products that are prohibited by law.
Okay. All right. So read that line from the Constitution one more time, because it sounded pretty straightforward to me.
Any person may sell or peddle the products of the farm or garden occupied and cultivated by him without obtaining a license thereof. Therefore, excuse me.
Okay. And then the Supreme Court interpreted that to mean that...
Well, not illegal not stuff. Really. Yeah, not stuff prohibited by law. And that was in a case...
Ridiculous.
Who, for Diane and Michael Hartman of Gibbon, who sold meat and raw milk from their farm. So that was... Wow.
So they're not talking about drugs.
They were not talking about marijuana in that case.
Anything, meat.
Anything that's illegal to sell, they're saying that provision of the Constitution doesn't apply to that. So, I mean, it just goes to show that even something that seems crystal clear that is written into a constitution can be interpreted in a way that you don't agree with and that you would be shocked to find out about that. That doesn't shock me because I've heard enough court decisions that, you know, interpret things in ridiculous state-approved ways that I'm not shocked by it. But there could be a lot of people out there who would be shocked that a sentence like that could be interpreted to mean, oh, well, no, except for these other things that we say.
I guess I'm not shocked by this one because, you know, I mean, if it was marijuana, for instance, you brought up marijuana right away, as you would.
Yep.
And, you know, somebody says, hey, wait, you know, some pot dealer who's grown some weed and was growing it in his closet or whatever. He ends up taking his case to court and says, hey, wait, there's this provision in the Constitution that says I can sell anything I want from my garden. I don't need your license. And I guess I'm not surprised that that guy somehow gets shut down by the courts. So, therefore, I guess I shouldn't be surprised that somebody selling raw milk gets shut down.
Nope. The law's the law, son.
It's a bunch of crap.
Yeah.
And it clearly isn't going to make a difference, but this is how the drug war destroyed our rights. Like, you had a right in 1906 when this was passed in Minnesota, all these good speeds and folks from you know, up there in Minnesota, they could sell whatever they wanted out of their gardens. They didn't need a license.
No, wait. What makes you think the drug war has anything to do with this?
Because it's about marijuana.
Raw milk.
Because
the case you mentioned was about farm items.
Yes,
that was in 2005.
In 2005, when those judges sat down and they thought about it, they said, well, what if this was wheat? What if this was opium puppies? And
yeah, but I thought you said that case that they were looking at was about farm products.
It was.
Okay.
But
you're speculating.
I am speculating as to what they thought when they did it, because they had to make a ruling that sort of addressed prohibited things. And at the time, marijuana and opium was also prohibited, just like raw milk.
I don't know. When I attended the trial of Vernon Hershberger, the case was about raw milk also. They didn't bring up drugs as any other reason for, you know, the precedent-setting decision.
Right. I don't think that just because drugs were illegal, or even if we'd lived in a world where drugs were not made illegal, that doesn't mean you still wouldn't have a nanny state trying to tell people they can't have raw milk.
Yeah, they say it's about the consumer. They have to protect the consumers. And think of the children.
Well, someone could get sick, right? Isn't that the fear-mongering that goes on with raw milk?
Somebody could get sick.
It hasn't been pasteurized, and so there's some level of risk involved. The toll-free number.
They sell soft cheeses in the grocery store.
Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. You tell us what you think.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
It takes a lot of courage to face your own death, but I'm glad I finally did. See, I was putting off getting life insurance to protect my family, even though I knew it was important. Then my neighbor's husband died. I watched her struggle emotionally and financially. It really made me face reality. If my husband died, how would I pay the mortgage, the car payments, or keep up the life the kids and I had? I realized I needed to get us life insurance right away. So I called AIG Direct. In less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing my family has protection.
Call AIG Direct right now for a free, no-obligation quote. The call takes less than 5 minutes, and you can save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-463-9184. That's 1-800-463-9184. 1-800-463-9184.
Hi, this is Mark Edge, host of Free Talk Live.
We've been witnessing a meltdown of the very economic engine that powers this country. With a printing press tethered to Washington politicians, bureaucrats, and central bankers, how can we put our trust in paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Come see gold.freetalklive.com or call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold. With Washington, D.C. delivering more debt and printed promises, common sense tells us the future of the trend is obvious. Everyone listening should visit gold.freetalklive.com or call 877-357-9938. I trust Midas Resources for my gold, silver, platinum, and you can too. Again, I want you to have this book, and it's free. It's gold.freetalklive.com or 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenvention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenvention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenvention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special super early bird price of just $40 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $40 price only lasts through early March, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenvention.info. Visit keenvention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenvention.info. If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com. When I found the Free State Project, I knew it was the key to achieving liberty in my lifetime. It's awesome to be surrounded by like-minded, freedom-loving activists who've moved here to New Hampshire. From politics to civil disobedience, we have it all. Where I came from, it felt that no matter what I did, liberty was dying. Perhaps you feel the same way? Call 888-377-2515 now to learn more about the Free State Project. That's 888-377-2515 or visit freestateproject.org.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
$500 a day. That is what one farmer is facing for refusing to allow government bureaucrats to come and search his raw milk operation, his farm in Minnesota. That is the story, Mark, you're sharing with us. We're going to continue with it here in a moment. You can share your thoughts. Maybe you are against raw milk. Maybe you're somebody who supports the government coming into these farms and shutting them down. The children could be harmed. We must do everything that it takes to put a stop to these purveyors, these pushers of raw milk. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number.
I think it's fair to point out that raw milk can have problems. It is probably more dangerous to drink than pasteurized, homogenized milk if we're looking at sort of diseases. Mm-hmm. But many people believe that it's the live enzymes in the milk that that's significantly more healthy. There's this movement out there. The name is passing me by. Nourishing Traditions, I think is what it's called, is a book that was written by some gentleman. Anyway, and they're really into this raw milk thing. So the question that really comes up here is not whether or not I don't want to have a conversation with some, table pounder about, pasteurized, homogenized milk is better for you, because I can't have that conversation. I don't know if it's better for you. And
What's the worst case scenario with raw milk? Could you die from it?
Yeah, absolutely. Sure.
Well, that's why I imagine some people feel pretty strongly about it.
You can get very sick about from soft cheeses, which they sell in grocery stores, too. There's all kinds of things that you can sit and get sick and die from. You know, that's life. You will die. None of us get out of this alive. Unless you go to alcor.org and join like I have. Get your head cut off and put it in a freezer.
Is that true? You've done that?
He really has.
I'll have, yeah. Would you like to see look, I carry this thing around. This little bracelet here. Oh, it's instructions.
This says, like, wait, don't cut my head off yet. You have to know the address to send it to first?
Well, they show up and pick up your body. That's part of what the sort of fee is.
Do they fly in on, like, teleporter or spacecraft? Or
what? Nope, no spacecraft that I know of. They probably take coach.
Well, so the way it works, Mark, is you've bought an insurance policy to cover the cost because it's fairly, you know, expensive cryogenically freeze yourself.
$80,000 to freeze your head, but if you get a life insurance policy that you know, make them the beneficiary, it's a significantly less costly. You can do it sort of on an annual basis, and when the inevitable occurs, then your head will be stuck in a cryonic freezer. I'm hoping that human life is extended indefinitely inside of my lifetime, but Derek J, you've got another 20 years on me, so I'm just doing what it takes here. This is my insurance policy.
Hmm. So for that, do you have to estimate what your head is worth?
I don't think so. No.
Is everybody's head worth the same?
Anybody can get $80,000 worth of life insurance if they pay the bill.
Okay. What's it cost for that per month?
I don't know monthly. I think I don't know. I don't pay the bills. Laura does.
That's nice. All right. So let's go on with raw milk, please.
Yeah.
So what else is going on?
I basically
here?
Read the article to
you. Oh,
you
did? Yeah. Okay. All right. So this guy's facing $500 a day in fines. He's going to court, right? Has he been charged with something? Or is this like just a civil, we're going to extract the fines from you kind of thing?
Well, they're trying to get a ruling from the court to put those fines on him.
I see.
There is a little more here. The one big difference between the Hartman case and Berglund's is that Hartman was accused in 2010 of having sold milk that sickened 8 people with a coli. Mm. Berglund hasn't been accused of any safety transgressions. Despite the accusations, Hartman battled against the MDA's seemingly relentless pursuit and eventually in 2013 won a court decision in which the agency was ruled to have illegally searched the farmer's truck. In 2014, a judge dismissed a charge of Hartman's having violated probation. He'd been put on probation when he pleaded guilty to a charge of violating regulations intended for his wife. So a court hearing will be held next week regarding the Berglund case.
You know, you had commented earlier, Mark, that you blame the war on drugs for this. And I pointed out that even if it wasn't for the war on drugs, we may still have a nanny state trying to protect the consumer here by punishing and threatening farmers. So I don't think it's necessarily the case that one follows the other. However, you can certainly say that had people stood up against the war on drugs on a principled basis, rather than standing aside and saying, well, you should do that to those drug users. They're bad people. How dare they try to alter their state of consciousness? We need to put them in jail. And now, oh, look, now they're doing it to milk drinkers. I mean, I think it just shows how absolutely absurd and restrictive the government can get. Who would have ever thought they would be targeted over their choice of beverage that, you know, everyone would have considered a sort of healthy, innocent thing. But now milk drinkers are under the government's gun, and the more specifically, the milk producers, many of them sometimes Amish farmers and Amish families. I mean, this is just, it shows the ridiculous absurdity of this government. And certainly you could argue that people who support freedom need to support it across the board. You can't wait until your freedoms are being threatened. Whenever anyone's freedoms are being threatened, you, even if you aren't a raw milk drinker, or even if you aren't a cannabis user or a heroin user or whatever, you should stand up for the freedoms of other people. Because if you don't, then you shouldn't be surprised when it becomes time for your turn. When the government comes to you and they come after something that you love, whether it's a product or service or your lifestyle, they come after you. Don't be surprised if there's no one left to come up and stand for you.
Yeah, I'm grateful that here in New Hampshire, we don't have these particular rules. My son is probably...
The raw milk rules?
Yeah, half constructed of raw milk. You know, he really loved milk for you know, the first few years. Now he doesn't drink it at all, but that was his thing. And we got raw milk. You know, my wife would go out of her way
to
drive.
What does he drink instead of milk?
Water.
Okay.
He doesn't really, not much. He's really crazy about orange juice, which is basically just sugar water, you know.
Yeah, but it's pretty good. All right, so comments further on raw milk?
Yeah, if only the recreational drug users were as motivated as the raw milk people on these issues to come to the defense of people like this farmer or their drug dealer, for example. Because it seems like the raw milk issue really mobilizes a lot of activists and customers to come out to the defense of their supplier.
There are a lot of pot smokers that will come out to a 420 celebration.
Yeah, but I think the difference is really made in the courtroom when the person facing charges is on the stand. I've seen courtrooms packed with peaceful families who enjoy raw milk. It would be cool to see peaceful families, doctors, and other folks who enjoy smoking cannabis or whatever recreational drug at the defense of their dealer.
When you say this, though, Derek, aren't you really just calling out the activists that say ignore the government and it'll go away? I mean, in many cases, there are activists out there that say, you know, don't vote, don't participate in the system, because if you, you know, voting only encourages them. Really, going to court and standing up to the people in the judicial systems, no different than going to the voting booth and trying to stand up to people in the legislative decision. Isn't that really just call those activists out?
I don't know. I wasn't trying to. Well, yeah, I guess I'm calling out. I don't know if I would say they're activists. I just think there are a lot of people who enjoy. Well, people who enjoy recreational drugs hear about friends getting busted. I know I did. Mm-hmm. And attending their trials, doing some jury nullification outreach could make all the difference for them. It made the difference for Vernon Hirschberger, who sells raw milk, and he had a packed courtroom filled with customers.
Well, one of the things, I think a key difference here is that, and I'm not coming to the defense of lazy people anywhere, but one of the key differences is there is the stigma attached with recreational drug use, right? That's why you don't see the doctors and the lawyers coming out to the 420 celebrations, even though they're getting high too. They just don't want to be seen for it in public. More coming up.
Now you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoin by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
Months after identifying the elusive Higgs boson particle, scientists at CERN in Geneva, Switzerland have announced that they've completely run out of things to do with their Large Hadron Collider.
We've tried some time travel stuff, but it doesn't really work. Black holes, but we already know like a ton about those. Last week, we threw a bird in there. Honestly, we thought it would take way longer to find the Higgs boson.
Director General of CERN, Ralf Dieter Hauer, told reporters that while they, quote, might be able to figure out some more about quarks or something, for the most part, his team has spent much of the past year throwing pennies into the machine and turning it on to see if the pennies come out smushed.
We might just start building a larger hadron collider. Yeah, maybe a bigger collider for smaller hadrons or something. I don't know.
CERN has announced on their website that if anyone out there has any fun ideas for experiments, you can email them to ideas@largehadroncollider.com.
This is the Onion News Network.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Lil Drums. Every bit as fun as a full-size Nestle drumstick cone and definitely cuter. Visit us at drumstick.com. Vacations are all about family time, but you don't have to leave home to have fun. Take one weekend a month and devote it to family activities. Pull out the board games and puzzles, serve up some treats, or have a picnic. Even without leaving home, you'll feel like you've really had some time away. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's post pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the liberty media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
You can take control of the airwaves here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Coming up, Ross Ulbricht's attorney motions to retry the case. Of course, Ross Ulbricht found guilty by a jury earlier this year, of running the Silk Road, the underground drug marketplace, and we'll go over the reason why his attorney's saying he deserves another crack at yet another jury trial. Our toll-free number tonight is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And join us via Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. So you can still talk about raw milk and some of the other stuff we discussed, grave robbing, whatever you'd like to discuss here tonight on Free Talk Live. But also, Derek J., you have something that you wanted to share about this so-called Internet Freedom Act. We'll learn more about that with you in a moment. But first, ExpressCoin. That's the best choice for getting your cryptocurrencies. Whether it's Bitcoin, Litecoin, or Dogecoin, it's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. And ExpressCoin is a licensed money services business. You can get your cryptocurrencies with money order, check, or wire transfer. Just start off over at ExpressCoin.com, whether you're in the U.S. or Canada. ExpressCoin.com. Plus, they've got an app for your smartphone. It's free, of course. You can go and download it at ExpressCoin.com. And when you're ready to buy over at ExpressCoin.com, use coupon code FTL, and you'll get up to $40 worth of your cryptocurrency of choice with no fee whatsoever. ExpressCoin.com, coupon code FTL. So, Derek J., of course, there was a lot of news over the last couple of weeks about this net neutrality, as it is called, the FCC taking power over the internet, taking more power than ever before over the operations of the internet, with two FCC commissioners voting against and three voting in favor of these rules, split down party lines. Mm-hmm. One of the guys voting against it said that this essentially gives the FCC total control over all aspects of the internet, which, to me, doesn't sound like a very good thing, yet there are people out there, even who call themselves libertarians, who seem to believe that the government is somehow going to make the internet a better place. Even though the government, everything it has touched in the past has turned to junk and has broken and has become very expensive and monopolistic, somehow they believe this governmental interference is going to make things better. And now there's some sort of proposal to try to undo things. What's going on?
Yeah, so there is a proposal to undo things. It is still a bill that's before the House, but it's something that's freaking out a lot of websites that have a lot of like a tech background. So I've got options here, and I'd like to know what you and Mark think. Would you prefer that I read from an article which is a little more neutral towards the issue, or one that has a very clear bias against the issue? Because I think both can be a little fun.
Bias against meaning that the article would be in favor of net neutrality?
Yeah, okay. Correct.
I say that one.
One thing that I find with these articles is the ones that attempt to be neutral aren't very good with reporting facts. They'll just sort of give you an overview. This is what the disagreement is. Look, there's a disagreement. See, disagreement.
I want the article that's going to pick this apart.
Right, and yeah. I think that you can get more facts if you find ones that are biased. Now, I'll admit, I think you should read both sides to know what they the complaints are on both sides, but I think that biased articles have a great deal of value.
So here's the biased article from thedailybeast.com. Headline, "The Campaign Cash That Can Kill the Open Internet." So obviously, you can already tell where it's coming from. This author, Ben Collins, prefers net neutrality, the FCC-controlled, government-run internet, over the one that we had before, which apparently was not open. I was not aware. But now, so he writes, "All but two of the 31 co-sponsors of a House bill to kill net neutrality received thousands from telecoms in just the last election cycle. Is there cash enough to end a free web? The Internet Freedom Act is a House bill intended to destroy newly instituted net neutrality rights. And of the bill's 31 co-sponsors, all but two of them received money from a major telecom or its lobby in 2014 alone."
It's so probably true that if you looked at, you know, what is it, 430, how many of them are there? 435 or something?
Congress critters?
Something
435.
Like yeah. If, plus I bet 100 if you senators. Looked at, I bet if you looked at all 435 of them, it'd probably be 400 of them that received money from the telecom industry, if not 430 of them.
I mean, yeah. So why wouldn't the telecom industry lobby these people?
They give, I mean, usually the way it works is these corporations, these mega corporations, give to everybody just because they want them all in their pocket.
Right. So whether or not net neutrality was on the table, or any issue in particular was on the table, they would want to give money to these bureaucrats, right, these politicians, just so that things go in their favor.
Sure.
It also strikes me as odd when he uses this language that intended to destroy newly instituted net neutrality rights. Like, we got new rights.
Right.
And you just want to take them away.
Because the government gives people rights, is the idea.
Yeah, it's
That's
silly.
Not true, right?
Yeah, but Ben Collins doesn't know that. So he continues.
Well, before you go on, let's explain why that's not true. Because some people do believe that, like, the Constitution gave people rights, and that, you know, the Civil Rights Act gave people rights, and that these other things, you know, that the government has done has given people rights. And so they believe that somehow rights come from people writing things down on pieces of paper.
Yeah, but that couldn't be, because people can't give you rights that they themselves don't have, and groups of people can't have more rights than any individual. So if you yourself as an individual don't have certain rights, then getting together with a big group of people doesn't create new rights that you can then give away. And that's essentially what the government argues it does. So that's invalid. 29 co-sponsors received $800,000 from AT&T, Verizon, Comcast, Time Warner Cable, and their lobby, the National Cable and Telecommunications Association. So there's your facts, Mark.
Yep.
You said these articles tend to have more of those, and you seem to be right so far. The legislation would invalidate rules instituted by the FCC last week that declared the internet a public utility and disallowed telecoms from forcibly slowing or blocking web traffic to competitors, or separating the web into artificial cable packaged-like tiers for lower-paying users. So, what interesting language this guy uses. Well, he's got everything flipped upside down.
The idea is that once you call something a utility, then everybody has to have it. Then it's a right when it comes to a utility. And the government should run it, because the government's really good at distributing rights to people. And, you know, really, it doesn't violate people's rights much at all. And that's ridiculous. I mean, is it a utility? Okay, it can be a utility, but that's still just a service. Up here in New Hampshire, where we live, we get our garbage picked up by private companies. Mm-hmm. Is garbage pickup a utility? I suppose it is here, done by private companies, and it's done at the same price and better service here than it is elsewhere.
But it's not called a public utility, right?
I guess it's not public utility.
It's run by private companies.
Yeah, I mean, this is just the terminology that gets used.
Mm-hmm.
There are places around the United States where electricity is delivered by competing organizations.
Well, now I'm a little concerned here, because what you just read, Derek J., makes me think that maybe these net neutrality rules are going to make it so that internet will change in its billing method. I mean, for instance, you know how like wireless companies, if you go over the cap that they have, so you may have a 2 gigabyte per month cap. You go over that cap, they will either throttle your data, meaning you'll get slowed down quite a bit, or they'll start charging you per gigabyte over the cap and charging you quite a bit. So I wonder, are we going to see home and business internet accounts starting to charge per gigabyte rather than having the different tiers? Because they were saying they wanted to get – it sounded like he was saying that he wanted to get rid of tiers. Now, I'm not sure if that's what this these regulations will end up doing. Obviously, no one's read them yet. The 300 pages that the FCC signed into their regulations a couple of weeks ago were not available prior to and not available still since – the vote, from what I understand, they apparently will not be available until they go into effect. At least that's what I've read about this. So can you imagine how frustrating that would be? I mean, I like just having a nice, flat, predictable fee for my internet use. I don't want to go back to the days of CompuServe or AOL back in a long time ago where you literally paid by the minute to use a service. And so the more data that you used, the more that you would pay. My parents, I racked up a $200 bill one month because I didn't know that. I was a young teenager. I had no idea how these things were billed. And boy, were my parents pissed over that one. Would you want to pay for your internet that way?
Not particularly. I mean,
by data?
Unless it was cheaper.
Where everybody gets the same speed, but they're paying per gigabyte, so there's no more tiers. Because right now, you can pay for a lower tier, you can pay for a higher tier, and get more bandwidth that way. It's Free Talk Live. We'll come back with more on the Internet Freedom Act in moments.
I walk my dog every day.
We walk every morning.
And I've got the best-looking dog in the neighborhood named Stanley. He's a collie mix.
Teddy is a rescue dog. He's a lab.
We meet the same people every day.
People comment about what a beautiful black coat he has.
They'll tell me, oh, he's so soft and he's so silky.
There's a difference when I compare Teddy to the other dogs.
And these dogs that have the brittle hair, it's coarse. It doesn't lay nice. It's not shiny. It's dull. I tell them about Dynavite.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
I've told them this is what I use.
The omega-3 fatty acids.
Flaxseed, zinc, alfalfa.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
And it really made his coat shiny.
You know, it didn't take very long. They've got their nice, expensive jogging suit on, and their dog has their smooth, beautiful, soft, shiny coat. So now their dog looks just as good as they do.
859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
So who else will you meet at the Get Prepared Expo? For starters, from Republic Broadcasting, John Moore and John Stadtmiller. From GCN, Aaron and Brad Dakins, Joyce Riley, and me, Vincent Finelli. Joining us are the instructors whom you've learned to trust. Surgeon of the Year, Dr. Norman Shuley. Engineer, Matt Stein. The real Fox Mulder of the X-Files, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Author and analyst, Captain John Reagan. Your counterterrorist from Central America, Mike Ma. Dental center owner and my dentist, Dr. Howard Shane. Radiation instructor, Craig Douglas. Author and survivalist, Rich Sheban. Author, Judy Dollarhite. Cancer center owner from Mexico, Dr. Patrick Vickers. Bug out expert and pilot, Captain Bill Sermo. Beekeeper, Jeff Maddox. Seedsman, Mike Knox. Author, Gayla Pruitt. Author Harry Cooper, food expert Joe Acapinti, and Bill Whaley, the Junk Man, March 27, 28, and 29. GetPreparedExpo.com, the largest preparedness and survival expo in the USA.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. Woo! That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolf. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.lrn.fm to learn how. Broadcast.lrn.fm.
Now, more Free Talk Live. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, and we've got Skype. You can Skype in at username lrn.fm. Joining you in studio, it's Ian here.
Derek J.
And Mark.
We'll continue with your calls and also want to invite you to our website. Drop by freetalklive.com. Get your shopping done over at shop.freetalklive.com. There are links to Amazon there, Amazon UK, Amazon Canada, and Amazon US. You just go and, you know, get whatever you want. It's Amazon. You know, you're used to their great free super saver shipping deals, or Amazon Prime, or, you know, whatever it is that you're using to ship. It's always usually a pretty good deal over at Amazon. The prices are great. The reviews are super helpful. So it's the same great experience you're used to. You're just a cut of the sale is going to go to Free Talk Live. Same great prices. They're just not keeping all the profits when you go through shop.freetalklive.com. They send some our way. So once again, shop.freetalklive.com. Lucas is in Raleigh, North Carolina. You're on Free Talk Live. Listening to Talk Radio 850.
Hey, well, thanks for having me. I had a couple of points to bring up. The first one is about this question of a publicly regulated utility, which I think is important to ask. You know, what are they and why do we have them? Because actually they're really essential to the functioning of most communities and the survival of the individuals that live in them. But the second part of that that I think was really interesting about the discussion you're having is this question of who has rights, who gets rights, and where do they come from? Because the position you just took actually is one I think a lot of liberals would agree with, that entities besides individual people can't have rights, which means, for example, corporations, which are groups of people, wouldn't have any rights.
Yeah, corporations aren't like people because they're imaginary file folders, you know, with papers in them. That's
right.
All corporations
are. So they shouldn't have rights, right?
That's correct. Corporations don't exist. Okay. They're just imaginary legal fictions.
Citizens United. We're in agreement that Citizens United is a crazy fictional decision by a crazy Supreme Court. Let's go to the other issue.
I would
though.
Call it the Public cherry on the top. Before you go on, I'd call it the cherry on the top of more than a century of decisions that were like that. Though I mean, it in and of itself is very little comparison to what has gone on before.
Well, I don't know. I think the decision ultimately basically said. Corporations have political rights just like people do. And given that you can't, you can't jail a corporation for breaking the law, you can't execute a corporation for killing people, corporations are immortal and suffer no pain and no loss of any kind. There's nothing you can do to hurt a corporation. You can only really hurt the people that run it. So I think it's
yes, but that's not that is so, but that is not.
Okay.
I agree with. I mean, I
don't disagree with that. Yeah. It's just that he's misinterpreting Citizens United. The fact is, it's the 14th Amendment that has been used for more than 150 years to talk about the rights of corporations and organizations like this. That Citizens United is simply a cherry on the top of that sundae, and that's the point I'm trying to make. Something didn't magically turn around in the last 5 years. It was going on for 155.
What you mean to say, Mark, is that, you know, this isn't news that corporations by the government are considered to be persons.
Right, they call them persons. They've called them persons for a long time.
You can go back into Black's Law Dictionary all the way back into the 1800s and find a definition of corporation that will include the word person.
Right, because people do make up corporations, and that's something Mitt Romney was kind of right about, even though he allied it to some important points there. And I think the question about Citizens United is, should corporations have more rights to spend money on campaigns than the rest of us human beings? And the answer there, I think, is pretty definitively, I don't know how you say yes to that and still feel like we live in a democracy.
I don't feel like we live in a democracy, and I don't feel like really what it comes down to for me is that money and power have never been separated in human history. So this is just a complaint about the way that money and power get put together.
Yeah, there's no rules that you can set that are going to make it so that the you know things aren't unfairly tilted towards those with money, right? Like, so even if you could say, okay, no more corporate donations to political campaigns— Well, then still there are going to be ways to get
around
that.
Don't worry, the rich people will still run the system.
Yeah.
They did before. They will now. But
obviously, you can't completely eliminate money from the system of politics, or candidates won't be able to get their names out. On the other hand, what we have done with Citizens United is really kind of unlock the box and make it totally open for as much money as you want to spend, as opposed to what we used to do, which was some reasonable regulation that keeps people with money from being as powerful as they possibly could be compared to people
who don't have
any
savings. System sucked 10 years ago, man.
I'm just saying, are you saying in the history of mankind, the relationship with money between money and politics has always been the same?
Well, I wouldn't call it the same. I would say that when we had kings and nobles and you worked, you worked the farm because they told you to and they'd cut your head off, it was probably worse.
There you go. And did the amount of money, the small pittance of money that peasants have, did that enable them to compete in the political arena? The answer was no.
No.
Right?
So nothing's changed, really.
Well, yes, something changed. We managed to more evenly distribute that money than a feudal system did. We more evenly distribute wealth. We have something called the middle class that didn't exist in a feudal system.
Well, it grew up over time, but...
That's new.
It really came about in the Gilded Age prior to, and was destroyed by the Progressive Era. So during the Gilded Age, what you saw is real income double from 1870 to 1890. And then the progressives, which sort of topped off with Wilson and then went on to FDR.
Income? You mean the average? What do you mean by real income? Do you mean the average income for all people or average or median income?
The income for working people doubled in that time frame.
Working people, so people below a certain amount of income doubled their income, you're saying?
That's correct. I can go back and I can really dig in if you want to find those numbers out.
I'm not arguing about that. I'm just, my only point about that question would be a causation versus correlation question. I don't know that you can say specifically that progressive policies killed that off, as opposed to the same thing that stopped Japanese growth, which is, you know, you do run up against certain limits of, everybody can't just go out and dig up gold on their land anymore because we found all that. Everybody can't go out and find a piece of property and just start farming it because all the land in America is now owned.
Yeah, but in the 1870s,
right? Most of it by the government.
In the 1870s, we saw the jump. In the Gilded Era, what you saw was all kinds of inventions, railroads, cars, things like this were getting, airplanes, all this stuff was getting started.
Right?
All that stuff was getting started in that time frame, and those added real wealth. You see, money's not wealth. Money is a quantification of wealth.
No, I agree with you, but the point there is nobody can go out and invent the car again.
They can invent the flying car. It's government regulation which keeps it from being valuable because you can't fly.
You're saying we don't have flying cars because of government regulation?
Yes.
Absolutely, 100%.
Yeah, go and look into the...
Flying a plane is as easy as driving a car and as safe.
No, but I can tell you.
Private pilot.
God, this guy's like talking to the wall. So what I'm trying to say is that you would have automation right now that would fly the car for you, and you wouldn't have to do anything because the government keeps driverless cars off the road. It keeps flying machines out of the sky. It keeps the average person from being able to do this.
Is there a driverless car right now?
Yes.
I didn't finish my question. That has driven a million miles with a million different users without any accident.
Yes.
There have not been a million different users because
the 100
hundred thousand of these.
Do you want an answer to your question?
No, he doesn't. He wants to get on and prattle on and not want to have a conversation.
I'm just going to put him on hold here because he just keeps yelling underneath us trying to answer his questions that he's asking. Yes, there are driverless cars. Google is out there testing them. I don't know how many miles they've logged, but it's quite a few. But obviously not with a million drivers because no governments are allowing them to expand at that level. From what I understand, it's only California or maybe another state that is even allowing for the testing of these cars. And then, of course, to answer his question about the flying car question, Mahler Air Car, or Sky Car rather, has been around for a couple decades. It's existed. It just can't be marketed to the masses because the FAA stands in the way of it being existing. Look, you know, he talked about the middle class not existing before, and Mark, I think you kind of touched on this, but the reason why wealth is more better distributed than it was in the feudal system, for instance, is not because of government regulation, but in spite of it. Because during the 1800s, when those inventions were happening, there weren't a bunch of government regulators around to try to stop everybody from doing the things that they were wanting to do. Nobody was being threatened for selling raw milk in the 1800s. There weren't a bunch of nanny government regulators everywhere to stand in the way of innovation and development. And so when people are free to do things and to come up with ideas and to market products and services, then wealth can be created. And that means that people in the poorer areas are able to start their own businesses and create products and services and raise themselves up out of poverty. So it's because of government regulations is why money stays in the hands of the top 1%.
Who do you think writes them?
Thanks, Lucas, for your call tonight. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. More to come on the Internet Freedom Act. We're still in the middle of the story that Derek J. brought in. We'll get back to that on the way, plus the latest on Ross Ulbricht. It's Free Talk Live.
Indefinite extension of the human lifespan is coming. But is it coming soon enough for you and me? That's the $80,000 question. I say $80,000 because that's what it costs to have your head cryonically frozen by Alcor. I've committed to do it. I got a life insurance policy, and I made them the beneficiaries. Bam, my best shot at living forever. Interested? Contact them at alcor.org. ALCOR.ORG. Mention my name, and I get a free year of membership.
How fast are new Allegra gel caps?
I didn't know you got a cat fast.
How strong are new Allegra gel caps?
10 more logs to go strong.
Non-drowsy Allegra gives you noticeable relief of your toughest allergy symptoms in just 1 hour. 2 times faster than Claritin and stays strong for 24 hours.
It's relief when the pollen's off the charts strong, even in the convertible.
New Allegra gel caps. Nothing's faster. Nothing's stronger. Guaranteed or your money back. Visit Allegra.com. Use only as directed.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate, well, I know a guy who's really great. It's the realtor Mark Warden. Do you want a home with 20 acres, a lakeside cabin, any takers for renters, buyers, and sellers too? Mark Warden is the guy for you. PorcupineRealEstate.com.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used and more. It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates. Online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Monday, March 9th, 2015. Gold opened today at $1,169, no change. Silver opened at $15.81, down 10 cents. And Bitcoin is trading around $281. Today's Bitcoin price is brought to you by ExpressCoin, the fastest, most reliable way to buy Bitcoin. Buy Bitcoin today at ExpressCoin.com. In the news, to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the 1965 Bloody Sunday March in Selma, Alabama, thousands of people retraced the steps of the historic civil rights event. An estimated 70,000 people sang songs, cheered, and carried signs across the Edmund Pettus Bridge. The original march took place on March 7, 1965, and resulted in around 600 peaceful civil rights activists being beaten and sprayed with tear gas by white state troopers and local police. Saturday night, tens and thousands of Israelis gathered in Tel Aviv, calling for Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to be replaced in upcoming elections. The rally in Rabin Square was organized by a nonprofit organization calling for Israel to focus on health, education, housing, and the country's cost of living. The keynote speaker was former Mossad chief Meir Dagan, who recently accused Netanyahu of being responsible for, quote, the greatest strategic damage to Israel, end quote. Gun rights activists in Spokane, Washington, defied a recent court ruling that banned firearms outside a federal courthouse. Activists with Liberty for All rallied outside the U.S. Courthouse Plaza in Spokane following the February 25th arrest of a local gun supporter. The Department of Homeland Security instructed the protesters that a recent court ruling banned their weapons from being carried immediately outside the building. Despite that fact, activists held their rally directly outside the courthouse. Around 30 demonstrators with rifles held signs and chanted outside the building. No arrests were made. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by CoinArch, offering innovative trading solutions for Bitcoin. Do more than just buy and sell Bitcoin. Use long and short positions to profit in rising and falling markets and boost your returns through leverage. Visit CoinArch.com and sign up using coupon code MAX and get free brokerage for the first 7 days. That's CoinArch.com. Support also comes from the Texas Bitcoin Conference. Hear from speakers such as Charlie Shrem, Dr. Robert Murphy, Vitalik Buterin, and Catherine Bleich. March 28th and 29th at ACL Live at the Moody Theater. Tickets are on sale now at TexasBitcoinConference.com. Use coupon code LibertyBeat for $25 off your ticket. That's coupon code LibertyBeat at TexasBitcoinConference.com. This is the Liberty Beat for Monday, March 9th, 2015. Check out the website at thelibertybeat.com. On March 12th, Danish scientist Neil Harrit will appear in Danish High Court to argue that a journalist is guilty of libel for calling him a crackpot for his work on the September 11th attacks. Dr. Harrit plans to tell the three-judge panel that Søren K. Villemose is guilty of libel under Danish law for comparing Harrit's work to creationists and Holocaust deniers. In a 2012 article, Villemose called Harrit and skeptics of the official story crackpots. Harrit filed suit, but a lower court ruled against him in 2013.
I'm a scientist, and I have done more than 225 presentations on World Trade Center 7 and the Twin Towers, nothing beyond that. I have never pointed my fingers at anyone. I have presented scientific evidence, including the nanothermite paper, for that the official narrative of 9/11. Is false, is wrong. That's all I've been doing.
Harrit, a professor of chemistry for 40 years at the University of Copenhagen, said he plans to present evidence to the High Court that disproves the crackpot claim, including video of World Trade Center 7's destruction, dust samples, and testimony from two expert witnesses. Russian police claim to have found two men responsible for the recent murder of activist and Kremlin critic Boris Nemtsov. Reuters reports that five men were marched into a courtroom by mass security officers. One of the men is a former police officer from Chechnya, who apparently confessed to the crime. Nemtsov was shot and killed on February 27th near the Kremlin administration. The Liberty Beat is brought to you by Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. This is the Liberty Beat for Monday, March 9th, 2015. I'm Brian Hagan, reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
California is reeling from Super Rainbow Percival, which left a trail of devastation along the West Coast. A luminous band of destruction touched down in Santa Barbara. Percival set a record as the most powerful rainbow in U.S. history, with at least 30 confirmed fatalities and damage estimates in the billions. The vividly saturated colors seared through homes and roads, charring everything in its path. Those exposed to the rainbow's fury say they're lucky to be alive.
The sky was completely blue. All of a sudden, it's filled with brilliant hues of red and indigo.
All I can say is when I was a kid, rainbows didn't cut people in half.
Meteorologists say that Percival is just the latest in a pattern of increasingly dangerous rainbows, and that they're only growing stronger as global temperatures rise. Percival also comes on the heels of some extreme weather phenomena overseas. Authorities in the Philippines are still searching for thousands in the aftermath of mega sunset Wilma.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You can bring up whatever you'd like. We've been talking about net neutrality and this new bill that apparently is under a proposal in Washington, D.C., called the Internet Freedom Act, and Derek J. will resume telling us about that. You can tell us whatever's on your mind here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Plus, the latest on the Ross Ulbricht situation. Apparently, they're filing for a retrial. Will it be granted? Well, that's another question entirely, but we can tell you what the basis for the filing is coming up here in a moment. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, and we have Skype. You can Skype in at username lrn.fm. So, Derek Jake, can we recap, or can you recap where we've been so far in this story, and where is it coming from again?
TheDailyBeast.com, okay. And the story is that last week there was a bill known as net neutrality that passed and
wasn't
was,
a bill
was signed
it, it or... was FCC regulations.
Okay, thanks for the correction.
So the FCC granted themselves more power.
Good for them.
Yeah, with and, no act of Congress.
Yeah, and a lot of people love that. You know, I don't, but a lot of people on the internet were really happy, like, yay, this language sounds like the internet's going to be more neutral, and I like that. And the government makes things more fair, usually, I guess, is what they're thinking.
They certainly tell us they do.
Yeah, so more government means more fair, so yay.
Even though a lot of the people who've defended freedom on the internet for a long time have defended against the government's encroachments, now all of a sudden they believe that same government that has for the last decade tried to come up with taxation schemes and control schemes and, of course, operates the NSA that, of course, is spying on people. Even though the government has done all kinds of things to destroy freedom online and in some cases has failed due to these very same activists who have been supporting net neutrality, now, for some reason, they believe that because the FCC is going to get involved, that everything's going to be better. It's just a crazy delusion.
Well, also, the suggestion is that somehow things are bad right now, right? So, like, at this moment...
Well, the mega corporations. So they want to use... of course, mega corporations are evil, and so therefore they want the megaest of all corporations to come in and put a stop to these mega corporations.
I don't disagree that the incentives are for, you know, corporations, large corporations, to act selfishly. The incentives for everyone in a lot of circumstances are to act selfishly. But there's also countering incentives that people want to go to regular websites and blogs and things like that. So the ISPs need to take that into consideration, too. So I don't know how it all would pan out in a, you know, as time goes by in a more free world. But, you know, the government decided long ago who the telephone monopoly is going to be, and a lot of people's internet's delivered along that. Many local governments decide who the cable monopoly is going to be, and the internet's delivered along that. The government can regulate the satellites in the sky in some cases, and decide, and the internet comes down upon that. The government is the one that limits this stuff, and then they're supposed to step in and be the referee. They've shown themselves traditionally to be very bad referees.
So, and here we are the next week after this net neutrality thing goes through, and there's a bill called the Internet Freedom Act, which was proposed by a woman named Marsha Blackburn, a Republican from Tennessee. And it's supposed to undo some of the regulations that the FCC invented for itself. So more on this story. I was pointing out some of the language in what is an admittedly biased article against this new Internet Freedom Act and for net neutrality. And one of the sentences we left off on was, the legislation would invalidate rules instituted by the FCC last week that declared the internet a public utility and disallowed telecoms from forcibly slowing or blocking web traffic to competitors or separating the web into artificial cable package-like tiers for lower-paying users. And there's a lot to unpack in that sentence, but to me, the first thing that sticks out is the word forcibly, because I care a lot about consent, and all things in my life operate by consent. And when I hear that term force, it stands out. So what's he saying? From forcibly slowing or blocking web traffic to competitors. I don't see that as force. I don't see not providing a service as tantamount to using force against someone. That's not the appropriate use of that word.
Well, yeah, I mean what this is all based on is the paranoia that this throttling or these restrictions on bandwidth will happen across the board, that all of the internet providers will start restricting the throughput of certain websites. And there's no real basis for that except just pure fear-mongering about what could happen, because companies could, in theory, set their networks up to restrict certain types of traffic. They can do that, but that, as you're saying, is not force. That's them using their property in the way that they think is going to benefit them. Now, I don't agree that it will benefit them, because I think in the long term, if a company tries to do that, the customers are going to bail out and they're going to go to the competitor.
Well, you're fear-mongering too. So what you're saying is that the government's going to come in and mess things up. What we have to
do
is...
That's what they always do. Well,
right. I mean, this is what we need to do, is we need to look at the statistical likelihood. So in one case, where the proposition is the government will come in and mess things up, and we can say that in many cases, most cases, I would say, the government, when it gets involved in regulation, that there are unintended consequences often that make the situation worse than it was before. In the other case, what's being proposed is that a product or service will not be available in the marketplace. Like, a free market will be bad at delivering a product or service. And what we can see historically is this really isn't the case, right? Like, government's really bad at delivering products and services. The free market, really good at it. Mm-hmm. So what you're saying is that somehow products and services won't be delivered in the marketplace, and I just don't think that's the case. Could costs go up to have sort of the whole internet? I suppose that's a possibility, in the same way that cable packages are put out there. If you want the whole world of costs of live sports or something like that, you'd have to pay more. And that for your basic stuff of people, the channels that people really want to get out there to you, that'll be less. I don't know. Would Google and Facebook get together and say, hey, we want to provide a free level of internet connectivity just for Google and Facebook? And they might very well do that. And then you'd have to pay, say, $40 a month to get to the rest of the internet. Is that fair? Well, no.
Is it force?
It's no. Certainly not force, but it's not fair to the websites that you have to pay to get to, because if you want your blog read, you'd have to give some money to the ISP. That's what the claim is here. And I'm not sure that the claim just sounds spurious to me.
Yeah. So you mentioned Google and Facebook, and I have to say those are two of the companies on which I spend the most time on the internet, probably on YouTube.
I call them
and Facebook.
Each half of the internet.
Yeah.
I mean, basically, if Google and Facebook are each half of the internet.
So if I could be offered a cable package-like tier for lower-paying users, as this one author puts it, where they say, hey, Derek, for $5 a month, you can have... every website that Google serves and every Facebook.
But you have to get to that website through Google when you go to the website.
Sure, fair enough. Whatever you want.
Rather than typing in a URL, freetalklive.com, you would have to go to Google and you'd have to type in Free Talk Live and then click on it. I think the vast majority of people would say, I'll take that service.
Yeah, I agree.
For free.
You know, if that's something that the price incentive makes sense, why wouldn't you want that to be offered? Just because they say it's for lower paying users. Oh, we don't want people to get less of an internet. Oh, what a shame that would be. But no, really, that could actually be a great thing. I don't need the whole internet. Some days I might, and then I could switch over to another provider who does provide that for a fee that I would afford to pay. But anyway, I just want to point out that this is not force. He's being tricky with his language, and what he's saying about web traffic being blocked to competitors hasn't really happened and wouldn't be the worst of all evils.
Some people claim it has happened.
Like what? That would be like Comcast, which is connected with NBC, providing their television content online, but then blocking people from being able to go to Fox.com or ABC.com and enjoy their online content.
Yeah, the claim
that's
is
not happening.
The claim is that it has happened, and I forget what it was, but that Verizon Wireless somehow restricted something. I'm sorry, I don't remember what it was, but it
sounds
was,
like baloney.
Yeah, I mean, it, for the most part, it hasn't happened, and I don't think it ever really would because of competition. But nonetheless, we'll come back with more.
Yes. Here,
you've got more. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And Skype in at username lrn.fm with your thoughts on whatever you want. It's Free Talk Live.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
It takes a lot of courage to face your own death. But I'm glad I finally did. See, I was putting off getting life insurance to protect my family, even though I knew it was important. Then my neighbor's husband died. I watched her struggle emotionally and financially. It really made me face reality. If my husband died, how would I pay the mortgage, the car payments, or keep up the life the kids and I had? I realized I needed to get us life insurance right away. So I called AIG Direct. In less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing my family has protection.
Call AIG Direct right now for a free, no-obligation quote. The call takes less than 5 minutes, and you can save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-463-9184. That's 1-800-463-9184. 1-800-463-9184.
Gold isn't for you?
Ted Anderson, president of Midas Resources, one of the world's premier gold and precious metal investing firms.
I get it.
You wouldn't buy gold if you believed that the government is doing a great job, that the Fed will stop handing out trillions of dollars like bailout candy, that Social Security would be there for you. That's not what's happening. You might even pass on gold if the stimulus package wouldn't fuel inflation, or that the dollar wouldn't lose value, or that your retirement would be secure. If all looks rosy to you, then now is not the time to buy gold. For the realist, there have never been more sobering reasons to diversify with gold. Since 2001, the U.S. dollar index has tanked 30% while gold has risen 300%. Right now, savvy investors are adding gold to their portfolios. You should too. Find out what they know. Call us and I'll send you 10 reasons why gold will do very well, free. 800-686-2237. 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237.
Hey, I'm Ian Freeman, one of the hosts of Free Talk Live. I created Free Talk Live in 2002 as an alternative to traditional talk radio. I wanted a show where anyone could call in and bring up any topic without fear of being screened out. Combined with our libertarian, voluntarist viewpoints, Free Talk Live is a unique syndicated radio show heard on FM and AM radio stations, coast to coast and beyond. I moved from my birthplace of Florida to New Hampshire in 2006 as part of the Free State Project. I'm also the program director of LRN.FM, which I launched in 2009 to create a place to present the best liberty-oriented audio programs from around the globe. I perform liberty outreach of all sorts and have done civil disobedience, non-cooperation, and run for office multiple times. Much of that's covered on my blog at freekeen.com. Thank you for listening to our shows, and if you want to support our work, please visit amp.freetalklive.com and contribute just $5 a month to our effective liberty outreach. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love, but make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Are you tired of governments murdering people around the world? Stop using their money. There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless, free market, non-political currency. Bitcoin cannot be inflated or controlled by any government. By using their money, you are helping the state. Stop doing it. You have an incredible alternative available now. Learn it, use it, spread it. Get started with Bitcoin at weusecoins.com. That's weusecoins.com.
You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
More Free Talk Live happening now. You can dial in toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Net neutrality discussion continuing here with a piece of legislation that's been proposed called the Internet Freedom Act. to supposedly undo some of the things the FCC did with its decision to make the internet a so-called public utility under what's called Title II a couple of weeks ago. Now, what I want to know is a couple things. One, how does the lady who's writing this bill know what the FCC's done? I thought it wasn't available, the 300-some pages that they passed. Does that mean Congress gets access to it, but other people don't? Because what I had heard was that only the FCC commissioners were the ones that had read the bill, or I guess bill's not the right word, but the regulations prior to them passing, and that the regulations would not be available publicly until after they go into effect, which wasn't happening immediately. So I'd like to know where that came from. Where, how did she know what to undo out of the FCC's rule set? And secondly, isn't this much ado about nothing? I mean, she's going to need the first of all, it needs to pass Congress, which it could in theory do because it's a Republican Congress, but the president's not going to sign this, right? Like, I mean,
probably
isn't
not.
Isn't this just essentially a campaign platform more than anything else?
Well, to some extent, you kind of have to put it out there in order to get it through at some point.
That's
right?
True.
You
That's
know,
true.
You just have to float it around. For instance, the SOPA thing, there was a lot of ado about that, and you kind of have to get the momentum. If for whatever reason you can communicate to Barack Obama that this is really important to the public. I don't think you will. I think that this is really well split, even like very even. And it's interesting that the Republicans, who probably know nothing in many cases about the internet, as evidenced by Lindsey Graham never having sent an email, are now on the side of non-net neutrality, which of course might be more neutral than net neutrality.
We'll talk more about it here in a moment and take your calls at 855-450-FREE. The Texas Bitcoin Conference is just around the corner. We're talking about 20 days now, March 28th to the 29th in Austin, Texas. It's happening in downtown Austin at the Moody Theater. The second annual Texas Bitcoin Conference will feature great speakers like world-famous investor, economist, and author George Gilder, IBM's architect of their blockchain technology, Sambala Nair will be flying in from India, Jason King, Robert Murphy, David Johnston, Charlie Shrem, and other speakers. Go to TexasBitcoinConference.com to get the full list and order your tickets using code FTL. That's FTL like Free Talk Live. You punch in FTL, you'll save $25 off the already affordable $150 admission price. And you'll also have $25 from your admission price be donated to Sean's Outpost, which is a great Bitcoin-based charity helping out homeless folks in North Florida. So go to TexasBitcoinConference.com. We were there last year for the first one,
yeah,
and we're going back this year.
Yep.
We'll be broadcasting live, which I'm very excited about. It was a really good time last year and looking forward to it again. So you can join us there and join all these wonderful Bitcoin experts and doers in the field, TexasBitcoinConference.com. Don't forget to use FTL as your discount code to get $25 off the ticket price. We'll continue to hear more on net neutrality and the proposed repeal of some of it. She's not repealing the entire 300 pages, so what things is she leaving in play? What things is she actually proposing to repeal? Maybe this thing won't be so as great as it sounds at all. I mean, who knows? We haven't actually read this, and I don't know if the author of the story has either. But let's go to Brian in Nashua, New Hampshire, listening to WSMN. Hello, Brian.
Good evening, Ian. Good evening, Mark. This is your friend who was at the conference over the weekend.
Oh, welcome.
And it's good to talk to you guys again, Brian Henschy. Anyway,
Derek Jay is in studio as well. Go ahead, Brian.
Oh, hey, Derek Jay.
Howdy.
So I just wanted to call in quickly and say I think it's bizarre. I also had the same experience with people on Facebook talking about how great it is. Oh my gosh, net neutrality! It's going to be equal and blah blah blah. And the whole thing with net neutrality to me is that it's more government intrusion. It's less freedom for individuals and for different companies. And when I try to stretch my brain and think about what government has gotten involved in, that's inserted itself into, that has actually gotten better, I can't really think of anything. I mean, look at healthcare as our most recent example. People
yeah.
lost their plan. People lost their doctors. Lots of people are unhappy.
A lot of doctors quit.
We're going to have that too. I just heard an interview yesterday or today about a doctor who left because of Obamacare. So, I mean,
okay, so let me take the other side on this one. I've got a couple of programs that I think worked out reasonably well, but I'm going to go ahead and take the big one. So the left will say, let's look at Social Security for a second here. I mean, you know, prior to Social Security, old people were dying on the streets. They were starving to death. They had no one to take care of them. Now with Social Security, they have some level of independence, and they're living longer.
My argument against that would be, number one, your health is your responsibility, not the government's. Number two, if you didn't plan during your lifetime for your retirement, if you're even going to retire, that's really your responsibility.
But you asked what government program worked. And, you know, that's so you're going to get a response is what government program worked, not whether or not it's moral.
I wouldn't argue that it has worked. And my reason being for that is because it's essentially bankrupt. It's running out of money year after year. The way the program was set up was a disaster. It was a ticking time bomb. That to me is not a successful program. A successful program to me is something that can actually fiscally work, and this doesn't.
Is it true, Mark, that old people were dying in the streets?
I don't know, but that's the picture they'll paint.
Okay, well then, I was gonna say I've never heard that one.
Well, you know, that's the picture that'll be painted. Of course, the rebuttal to what Brian's saying here is that hey, all we need to do is raise the cap on Social Security. Look at all these rich people making so much money. You take 7.5% of what they're making. Social Security's back solvent as it could possibly be because of the 1% bad.
Brian, what do you say to
that? And so what? At the end of the day, we have a program that can't pay for itself. Yes, it's set up wrong. Yes, it could be modified and changed. But as far as I know, the way that it's running, they're still running out of money. Even if they do make these changes, they're just going to be temporary fixes.
Well, right, one of the worst things I think about it is that I could use that 7.5% or 15%, depending on how one wants to quantify it, because an employer pays to have you around. They pay that other 7.5% for you, so you could argue that that's your paycheck. They take your money and they don't let you invest it the way you want. So Social Security for the average person comes back at about 1% increase over what they made. Some people make a killing on it and other people lose money. It's been shown that women live longer, whites live longer, rich people live longer. So Social Security is a program that for every one rich white woman who lives to, you know, 95 or whatever and collects it, you know, some three poor black men had to support her in doing it. So it is a wealth redistribution program from the poor to the rich, from the black to the white, and from the male to the female. But besides all that, I could just take the money that I was going to make and invest it in something that's better than 1% return, which is less than inflation.
You could also take that money and help your mom out or your dad out or whoever, you know, elderly folks that need to be taken care of, yep, rather than handing it over to government bureaucrats to waste away. Hey, thanks, Brian. Good call. Appreciate it. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And he's certainly right. There's no guarantee that any of us would be able to collect Social Security when we got to 65. Not that I've been paying in, so screw them. It's Free Talk Live.
So who else will you meet at the Get Prepared Expo? For starters, from Republic Broadcasting, John Moore and John Stadtmiller. From GCN, Aaron and Brad Dakins, Joyce Riley, and me, Vincent Finelli. Joining us are the instructors whom you've learned to trust. Surgeon of the Year, Dr. Norman Shuley. Engineer, Matt Stein. The real Fox Mulder of the X-Files, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Author and analyst, Captain John Reagan. Your counterterrorist from Central America, Mike Ma. Dental center owner and my dentist, Dr. Howard Shane. Radiation instructor, Craig Douglas. Author and survivalist, Rich Sheban. Author, Judy Dollarheit. Cancer center owner from Mexico, Dr. Patrick Vickers. Bug out expert and pilot, Captain Bill Sermo. Beekeeper, Jeff Maddox. Seedsman, Mike Knox. Author, Gayla Pruitt. Author Harry Cooper, food expert Joe Acapinti, and Bill Whaley, the Junk Man, March 27, 28, and 29. GetPreparedExpo.com, the largest preparedness and survival expo in the USA.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people
who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here. And I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing, to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101ReasonsFilm.com. 101ReasonsFilm.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at LRN.FM.
This is Free Talk Live. You may dial toll-free and bring up whatever's on your mind. 855-450-FREE. Coming up, the latest on the Silk Road case. And will it be coming back for round two? If Ross Ulbricht's attorney gets his way, it will. But, of course, the judge in the case hasn't let Ross Ulbricht's attorney get his way at all pretty much throughout the first trial, so I wouldn't expect her to grant this particular motion. We'll give you more details on what it entails here in a moment. And, of course, you can join us online anytime at freetalklive.com. Get interactive on our website for free with other Free Talk Live listeners at freetalklive.com. Let's go to your phone calls and thoughts as Travis is on the line with us in I don't know where. Travis, you're on Skype. Go ahead.
Hi, just say no from South Carolina.
All right, go ahead, sir.
I want to talk to you about the net neutrality case. From what I understand, the deal with Verizon is between Verizon and Netflix. Apparently, Netflix didn't want to pay their high bandwidth costs.
Yeah.
Because apparently, their amount of bandwidth they were using has gone up somewhere towards 50 to 60% of a good chunk of the total internet.
I heard it was 33% of the entire internet is what Netflix was using. And yeah, it was actually one of our online producers, SciFaze, who said apparently it was Comcast and Verizon that were allegedly slowing down Netflix. And
I heard it was all of them.
Hey, can I, a quick technical question: are you on a headset or something like that, or speakerphone?
I'm afraid so.
Okay, yeah, it sounds a little cruddy. But go ahead with your point.
Yeah, I don't know if you mentioned it earlier or not, but the biggest thing is they didn't want to pay for what they were using, and because they refused to pay, they continued to pay what their previous contract was. They did, in fact, throttle Netflix slowly, and that's where a lot of this came from, as far as net neutrality was for.
Yeah. That's the only source of throttling that I could ever find on the internet.
Travis, thanks for the thoughts. Appreciate the expertise. Thank you. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Okay, fine. So let's just take that and take him at his word, and that there's been more than one person who said this, that Verizon and Comcast were supposedly throttling Netflix, and that angered some people. Well, had things gone on for, you know, over a period of time, customers would have had a reason to quit. If you're a Netflix user and you can't watch your movie in HD, because what throttling means is that they're slowing down the connection, right? So when you're watching video, they're yep. streaming that video to you, and whatever that data rate is that they can stream it to you determines the quality of the video. And so if you've ever watched Netflix streaming, if you've got bandwidth issues, then they stream it at a lower bit rate because you still want to watch the movie. You want to likely see the movie without having to wait a half an hour for it to buffer or something like that. So
that doesn't work, by the way, on at least Amazon Prime. If you just sort of try to wait around, it'll
you can't do that.
Yeah,
huh?
It won't buffer. It's really not very effective.
So what they'll do is they'll send you to a 500 kilobit per second stream or a 1,000 kilobits instead of 2,000 kilobits, for instance, or 2 megabit. And so, you know, if you can get 1.5 or 2 megabit, you'll get HD quality. But if you don't get that level, then you'll get SD quality, the standard resolution, mm-hmm. the lower kind of DVD quality.
And sometimes you
resolution.
Get this pixelated big sort of squares in the screen.
That means
quality.
You've got real bandwidth
and
issues.
And then sometimes it just stops. Yeah. You know, that's just the way it is.
But I mean, if customers are only going to put up with that for so long, and they're going to call and they're going to complain, and if enough people are going, and if enough people complain and they don't do anything about it, they're going to look for another option, and whoever it is that's providing the better option for Netflix is going to get all that business, which could be significant.
Yeah, it's sad to me because of the existence of a state that any of this happens at all. It's like, if in the absence of the state, what would Netflix really be able to do? They would have the option to advertise ISPs that are not throttling them, you know, have
sure.
certain arrangements and play ads before their shows.
Have the Netflix approved ISP.
Right.
Give them their endorsement.
Yeah, they could, I imagine they could play ads and they could remove ads from ISPs like Comcast and Verizon if they are throttling them.
That's a good point.
Make it known to their customers like, hey, we'd like to make this service cheaper for you, but we're going to have to raise our rates because Comcast and Time Warner Cable, whoever it is, won't cooperate
right,
with
Right, the
us.
Same thing happens with satellite television. There was a recent sort of a variant on that happens with satellite TV. With satellite television and cable as well, they have individual agreements with each of the channel providers. So, you know, Disney provides ESPN and the Disney Channel and ABC and, you know, certain channels. Fox provides Fox and Fox News and Fox Business. And, you know, they have these different channels and they have individual agreements for all of them. And there was a recent situation, I think it was Dish, if I'm recalling correctly. Dish and Fox had some sort of a fallout with a renegotiation of a contract. And Dish, I think it was Fox that pulled their channel from Dish.
Oh, wow.
I'm sorry if I'm misremembering, but one side or the other pulled the channel. And so then, you know, Dish puts out this statement saying, hey, Fox tried to screw us. And Fox says, well, this is our side of the story. And they're trying to let their customers decide how to handle it. And obviously, Fox wanted their customers to abandon Dish. And Dish wanted their customers to call Fox and complain. And, you know,
vice versa, whatever it was.
Yeah, let the market decide. Let them handle these things.
Yeah, but unfortunately, a state does exist. And so companies like Netflix will go to them and say, this isn't fair. We can't negotiate an arrangement on an open marketplace. We can't be clever enough to tell our customers what's going on and incentivize the people we do business with to work in our favor. And so we'd like the heavy hand of government to come in and make the internet all the same for everybody. And I'm sure what their hope is, if I were Netflix, my hope would be going to the government and saying, you know, make it so that all ISPs have to give us full throttle internet, whatever it is. We want 1080p coming through the tubes for everybody. And that's probably their intention, but with unintended consequences of government regulation, I guarantee what's going to happen is you get 720p video for everybody, or even worse. You know, when everyone has to be provided the same quality service, the quality tends to diminish. It's
sure.
not like it's going to stay at that top tier.
Right. I mean, with my DSL that I get at my house, you have an option of paying more to get more megabytes per second or whatever. You have like
sign me up.
Yeah, tier of like 7.
I need more megabits.
I think it's like 2 or and 7 and 15.
By the way, Mark, a megabyte is 8 times the data as a megabit.
Fine. Yeah. I don't care. I just don't care.
Just saying.
Yeah. Don't care.
So, Derek J., is there more from this story that you felt was worth sharing?
Yeah, a little bit of background on it. I said that it was proposed by Marsha Blackburn, and she's a Republican from Tennessee, and 30 Republican colleagues in the last year. Now, this is a biased article against Blackburn in this bill. They're trying to make the case that, you know, she's in it for the big guys, the fat cats. And he says, in the last year, Blackburn received $87,000 from those ISPs and their lobby through her campaign committee and her political action committee. And wow, $87,000? Do they think that's what one politician can be bought for? Sounds like a pretty cheap price tag to me. I don't know.
I don't know either.
Bribery. Five other co-sponsors received $50,000 or more in the same cycle. Again, this is not sounding like, if it doesn't have a million figure in front of it, I'm not seeing it's any.
Well, these aren't presidential campaigns, so these are still just numbers of note.
Ugh.
Remember, when it comes to
50 grand for one buyout for a senator,
I don't know.
Doesn't sound like much.
Nobody on the other side's giving her any money.
Okay. The NCTA, and they gave that acronym for us earlier, the National Cable and Telecommunications Association, spent almost $200,000, or about 30% of its total Republican House spending budget, funding just 23 co-sponsors of this bill. So it sounds like they're pouring like a large majority of their money at this. And there are, 250 Republicans in the House, and the NCTA donated campaign money to about half of them last year.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to be shocked by any of this.
Yeah,
okay, what's new? People lobby, there's money going around D.C.
That's not a big deal. But to your point, it goes on later in the article to specify that the bill has virtually no chance of passing.
Right.
President Obama insisted in this year's State of the Union address, and in recent public comments, he'd veto any legislation that would allow ISPs to block traffic or create a speed toll for competitors or consumers on the web. So in other words, Obama will not allow companies or ISPs to offer certain services to their customers, even if that's what the services, even if that's what the customers want.
Not going
to
happen.
Yeah, this is just a campaign move. I mean, this is them being able to that way and, you know, doing this so they can in 2016
This
say,
is all about fair and bad corporations.
Yeah, we did this in 2016, but Obama stopped us. You need to vote for a Republican for president if you want internet freedom. Blah. It's Free Talk Live.
Shiny badges on your jacket. Shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from ShinyBadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at ShinyBadges.com, write WORMS in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
You hear that, kid? That's the hum of a well-run facility. You know what I hate hearing? Silence. Silence on a production line means downtime. Downtime means wasted time. Wasted time means wasted money. Silence isn't golden, kid. It's deadly. That's why I love Grainger. With a wide variety of the latest products, Grainger gets us what we need when we need it to help keep this place up and running and humming away. Get it? Got it? Good. Call, click Grainger.com, or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
If you're looking for work, you know what I mean by
elevator speech. It's the short version, saying just enough to make the listener want to listen more. Even if you're not a job seeker, effective communication skills have never been more important, with money and attention so scarce now. So to cut through the clutter, choose every single word as though it was the last word the person you're speaking to will hear. Otherwise, it might be. Instead of saying, due to the fact that, say, because, and avoid mispronunciations. Say jewelry, not jewelry, which could offend. Undoubtedly, you don't want to say undoubtedly. And whatever you do, never use a preposition to end a sentence with. Just kidding. For more tips, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Shiny badges on your jacket, shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write worms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. Moments remain, but there's enough time for you. If you dial now, toll free, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We've got Skype as well. Our Skype username is lrn.fm. Don't forget to go and check out Derek J on his new website URL.
Yeah. TheDerekJ.com.
TheDerekJ.com. You can still use the old one as well, DerekJ.me.
Yeah.
And it is very nicely laid out site with all of your media efforts, all easy to find in one place.
Yeah, thank you. There's going to be lots of Liberty Forum behind the scenes video coming up. Yeah, exclusive footage.
You were shooting video there?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, just, you know.
I didn't even notice.
Yeah, sneaking around and catching some candid shots of people producing live programs, and was lots of fun.
TheDerekJ.com, the new site.
That's it.
Go check him out over there and download all kinds of great Derek J content like Flaming Freedom.
Woo!
You're doing Freedom Fiends. You're doing Free Talk Live, of course.
And Cop Block Radio.
That's right. It's all there and more. Blog posts, video, etc. TheDerekJ.com. Ross Ulbricht. We have been covering his case in great detail. His mom was at the Liberty Forum this weekend giving what looked like it was an excellent presentation about how the government basically screwed over Ross and his defense attorney in the case that came to a close over a month ago now. It was early February, I think, when the Ross Ulbricht case wrapped up. But it's not over yet. Not if his attorney will get his way. According to, I believe this is ArsTechnica.com, Ross Ulbricht, convicted last month on federal charges of running the online drug bazaar Silk Road, is seeking a new trial premised on what his lawyers contend was the government's failure to provide evidence potentially pointing to his innocence in a, quote, timely manner, unquote. The New York federal jury on February 4th found the 30-year-old guilty on all seven federal charges of being the mastermind behind the site where hundreds of millions of dollars in illegal goods, including drugs and hacking tools, were traded with Bitcoin before authorities shuttered the site in late 2013.
But they haven't sentenced him yet, right?
That's correct. That's coming up in May.
See, this is... I think this is posturing for sentencing.
Okay.
You know, ultimately, that's what this is coming down to. I mean, you know, maybe he'll get another trial, but is it really going to be any different result? I mean, basically, they already said he did it.
Well, they said he created the Silk Road, but they didn't say that he had run it the entire time. They said that he ran it in the beginning and then handed it off to new operators who somehow enticed him to come back right before it got busted and essentially set him up. That story was never told during the trial because certain witnesses were prevented from testifying for the defense. And what also was never told was how the federal government even found the Silk Road server in the first place. Did they use illegal methods to uncover that information?
Sure.
Well, going on here, the argument is that Mr. Ulbricht should be granted a new trial because the government failed to provide exculpatory material and information in a timely manner, thereby denying him his Fifth Amendment right to due process and a fair trial, said Joshua Dreitel, the defendant's lead attorney, in a court filing on Friday. The motion, which also seeks to keep out evidence of the Silk Road servers discovered in Iceland, is not the first time Dreitel has sought a new trial on behalf of his client, who was known online as Dread Pirate Roberts. During the weeks-long case, Dreitel had called for a mistrial, demands that U.S. Judge Catherine Forrest declined. Among other allegations, Dreitel's motion says the government, just 2 weeks before trial, handed over some 5,000 pages of material concerning the nature of the upcoming testimony of a Department of Homeland Security agent who was the government's first witness. The evidence concerned, Dreitel wrote in his motion, quote, information about an alternative perpetrator, unquote. During the trial, Dreitel suggested the man who really controlled the Silk Road wasn't his young client, but Mark Karpeles, the wealthy former owner of the MT Gox Bitcoin exchange. Quote, you thought you had probable cause that Mark Karpeles was intimately involved as the head of Silk Road, correct? Dreitel had asked the Department of Homeland Security agent Jared Duryegahan during his cross-examination. The agent answered, quote, by the contents of that affidavit, yes. In 2013, he'd filled out papers asking a judge for a warrant to further investigate Karpeles, whom the authorities eventually cleared. Dreitel said in court on January 15th, quote, our position is that he set up Mr. Ulbricht. Karpeles has denied the allegations repeatedly. The 12-member jury reached its guilty verdicts on all seven counts after deliberating for less than 4 hours. Ulbricht faces up to life in prison, and the minimum, by the way, 30 years. Unless a new trial is granted, his scheduling is sentenced for May 15th. The government has until April to respond to Dreitel's latest defense efforts. And the seven charges against Ulbricht included 3 drug counts, distributing and distributing or aiding and abetting the distribution of narcotics, distributing narcotics or aiding and abetting distribution over the internet, and conspiracy to violate narcotics laws. He was also convicted on a 4th count of conspiracy to run a continuing criminal enterprise, which involves supervising at least 5 other people in an organization. That's the so-called kingpin charge. What's more, he was convicted on conspiracy charges for computer hacking, distributing false identification, and money laundering. Another issue Dreitel once relitigated is how the government discovered the Silk Road servers and whether it did it via denial of service attacks. So the motion has been filed in court for a retrial in the Silk Road case. I will link to this story here from Ars Technica because they actually do link to the court filing itself. So you can actually pull up the entire PDF, which is 33 pages, and you can sift through that. Now, this is likely going in front of the very same judge that had, you know, been completely complicit in allowing the prosecution to just run roughshod all over Ross Ulbricht's rights to a fair trial. I mean, there were multiple instances of this. One of the most egregious was the fact that the defense did not get the witness list that would be used against them until literally the weekend before the trial. So how it is you can possibly prepare a defense in a weekend's time, I really have no idea. And I don't know if that's mentioned in this 33-page motion. I haven't taken the time to read the entire thing.
How do they expect the outcome to be different if it's going to be tried before the same judge?
Well, it would be a different jury, and in theory, they would have more time to actually put a case together if this was granted, which there's almost no chance it'll be granted because it is the same judge.
Right. Yeah, the one thing that I think is extra legitimate about this challenge is that hopefully with the retrial, the defense will be aware of how the evidence was acquired. It sounds like they're asking for that evidence for this new trial, right? That they're like, we still don't know how the government acquired the copy of the Silk Road server that they claim to have.
Right, because they didn't call that particular witness.
Yeah.
Tarball, or whatever his name was.
So we don't really know how that was acquired. And I think that could play a big factor in the new jury's decision.
Well, right, because if they illegally gained access to that server...
Yeah, imagine if they're like, oh, well, yeah, we skipped over that in the first trial, but we just had our buddies over at the NSA just grab a copy, you know, when someone was on it.
And, which would
be
illegal.
And then the whole jury is like, well, wait a minute, you can do what? And you did what? We don't like that. So even if he is guilty, we're going to find him not guilty because you violated a person's rights. I mean, it's a lot of hoping, but I think it's the best chance they've got. Mark?
I think that's all they can do. I mean, this is what lawyers do. As far as I'm concerned, the team has stunk from the beginning. Yeah, they had an uphill battle with these judges and that sort of thing. But, you know, an attorney team that comes out of the gate and says, yeah, we did it, I'm not really that impressed with.
Yeah, I have to agree. I mean, that was not... I didn't think that was a very good strategy. But again, Ross is saying that everything that, you know, the attorneys have done, he's done with his consent, right?
Fine. Ross Ulbricht, from the looks of it, ran a drug enterprise inside of the United States, which is the punishes people more severely for drug crimes than most nations on the planet, has really the most effective drug catching apparatus out there. And he could have just as easily gone to another country. I'm sorry. It's not that I don't want bad things for him, but if you make poor decisions in life, you're going to get bad results. And this is a long series of bad decisions.
I'm trying to remember what it's called, and maybe one of you guys can remind me here. So if they put this motion in, obviously the state's going to respond and say, oh, everything was fine. And then the judge is going to say, I agree, everything was fine, and motion dismissed. He can then appeal to a higher level court. He can appeal the decision of that judge. What is that called? It's
an appeal?
No. It's an appeal that stops the trial.
Injunction?
Nope. Nope. There's a certain type of appeal, and I'm sorry.
You're the one who knows more about court.
I realize that. I'm just spacing on the name of it. But anyway, when a judge makes a decision that the court believes, or that the defense, or whoever believes is wrong, or the prosecution believes is wrong, they can basically interrupt the goings on of that trial, appeal that decision, and then once that decision is made by a higher level court, it then goes back to the initial trial.
I think hope for here is a low sentence, like something like 10 years or something.
Not
like
possible.
That.
The minimum is 30.
Well, it's possible.
No, it's not. The minimum is 30.
the judge. I mean, I guess they can do anything they want, but yeah, they would claim that her hands are tied.
Her hands certainly weren't tied through this thing as she, rigged the whole system all the way through.
Motion in limine? I don't know. That's not it. No, that's not it. Not motion. I don't know. I'll figure it out some other time. Probably as soon as I shut the mics off. All right, so we're done for tonight. We'll see you online between now and the next time, which is tomorrow night. For more Free Talk Live, go to freetalklive.com. And of course, as the Ulbricht case continues to develop, we will keep you in the loop. And don't forget to check out TheDerekJ.com.
Well, Free Talk Live.
Ms. Maxwell's local council has decided that the pool, which is only 2 feet deep, needs a lifeguard. It's a kiddie pool. As if the lifeguard wasn't enough, she's also been told she must have insurance. The health and safety edict came after she wrote to the city council asking for permission to put a bigger pool in the communal garden outside her home. Ah, that was her mistake, asking for permission rather than forgiveness. But nonetheless, not only was she told it was too dangerous, but the council told her to empty the existing pool. The Portsmouth manager defended the ruling yesterday. Nigel Selly said, "We didn't have sufficient assurances that the risks associated with providing such a facility would be well managed. It's a facility. How dare you? How dare you erect this structure on your property?
It's an inflatable pool.
Without our permission."
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With 4, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com. The 3 most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are 1, share 1 episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. 2, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. 3, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
The live edition of Liberty Conspiracy is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network, LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, March 9th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.84 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,172 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $279. Antiwar.com reports a U.S. airstrike hit an oil refinery in northern Syria yesterday in territory held by the Islamic State, killing at least 30 people, including a number of civilian workers employed at the site. Rebel mouthpiece, the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, reported that some of the Islamic State militants were killed in the attack, but that the rest were refinery workers from the surrounding area. Territory of the Islamic State includes most of the oil-producing regions of Syria, and the U.S. regularly targets the oil infrastructure there, saying it will deny the Islamic State the funds they get from oil smuggling. That's likely true, but the attacks are also badly crippling the only meaningful civilian economic infrastructure in those areas, in essence attacking the civilian economy militarily in the hopes of doing some damage by proxy to the occupying force. Bitcoin Not Bombs is a launching pad for nonprofits and social entrepreneurs into the financial freedom of the Bitcoin economy. Bitcoin Not Bombs is fully committed to being the hub of the nonprofit sector of the Bitcoin economy, maximizing the potential cross-promotion of all our clients and commercial partners. To learn more, visit BitcoinNotBombs.com. UPI reports one of two Swiss pilots will attempt to lift off from Abu Dhabi Monday for the first solar-powered flight around the world. Pilots Bertrand Picard and André Borschberg will attempt to circle the globe in 12 long flights over 5 months. The solar plane, called the Solar Impulse 2, can only fit one pilot, but they will fly the trip's segments in shifts. The plane is thin, with a long wingspan at over 236 feet across, and the wings are covered with over 17,000 solar cells. The plane can fly at night because of its ability to store energy it collects during the day. The plane will touch down in the United States, India, Oman, Myanmar, China, and either Southern Europe or North Africa, depending on conditions. The pilots have been planning the trip for over a decade, and Sir Richard Branson of Virgin Group is supporting the project. Part of the goal of the project is to promote green energy and environmental awareness. For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. Reuters reports the Greek finance minister said in a newspaper interview on Sunday that Greece could call a referendum or have early elections should its Eurozone partners reject its debt and growth plans. The new Greek government, led by Alexis Tsipras, won an election in January, promising to renegotiate a bailout agreement with the IMF.